There you go.
Oh, you could, I guess.
Please join me for the Pledge of Allegiance. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all. If we have a moment of silence, please remain standing for the people in France. Thank you. Welcome to the November 16, 2015 Selectmen's Meeting. First, we have public comment. Anyone wishing to make public comment? Seeing none, we'll move on to announcements and community calendar. Mr. Waddell?
I'm set.
Mr. Bridle?
I'm all set, thank you.
All set.
Mrs. Wolseley?
Good to go, thank you.
I do have one, sorry.
Yes.
The Thursday night, the firefighters are having their annual chili cook-off down to Wally's for funds raised for the Seacoast Fire, or the Hampton Firefighters Toy Bank, so.
Good.
If you enjoy chili, there's usually like 25 or 30 different types down there, and it's a good chance to get something to eat and raise some money for a good cause. Thank you.
Next, we have the consent agenda. Number one is request for restaurant beverage wine liquor license. Number two is Unitool Paul license petition.
I'll move the consent agenda, Mr. Chairman.
I'll second it.
All those in favor? Unanimous. Next, we move to Jane Seifer, town clerk, and Bob Cassassa, town moderator. Please join us at the table. Welcome.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Good evening.
Good evening. We were last before you in June of this year to talk about where to hold elections during the 2016 year, and I expressed my concerns at that time about whether our current arrangements would be suitable, and urged that they be examined. And as an outcome of that, the town manager reached out to Winnicunnet, and pleased to report that Winnicunnet has agreed to serve as the site for the presidential primary election, which right now I think is on for February 9th, although the town clerk may disagree with me, and also the November presidential general election. At the same time I was here in June, I asked the board to consider exploring whether the town should go to multiple polling locations. And since that meeting, the town clerk undertook a study and looked at the voting list and compiled statistics on how you would divide the town if you were to have more than one. In light of Winnicunnet's willingness to host in 2016, and in light of the fact that the statute says that if you approve multiple voting locations, such as if it were to appear on the March 2016 warrant, you go to multiple polling locations right away. So I don't believe a national presidential election is the best test case for or first run for your multiple polling sites. So to the extent that the board is interested in putting forth a warrant article to gauge the town's interest in multiple polling sites, I would suggest that that go forward in 2017, March of 2017, because if it passed in March of 2017, you don't have any elections scheduled for that off year beyond your town election, then you would first roll it out in, I'm going to say, a more forgiving environment in a off-cycle election where you would have a primary in 2018, you'd have a state election in November of 2018, and it's going to be a challenge to adopt more than one or to implement more than one polling place if the town so chooses to do that. So that's my report. Happy to say that Winnicunnet, very grateful to Winnicunnet, they're canceling school on that day to allow the town of Hampton to conduct its voting. so most appreciative. Takes a lot of pressure from my perspective off this concern.
Questions, Mr. Bridle?
No, I think it's a good idea. I think you guys have looked at it pretty good. It it doesn't make sense to do it this time. I have no problem with that at all.
Mrs. Wellesley?
Very nice. Thank you, Mr. Moderator.
Mr. Bean?
No questions. Thank you.
I go with their expertise and their knowledge and their experience.
I totally agree. And it's interesting that to hear how you feel it would be better to wait for another year.
If it doesn't work at Winnicott in February, we'll know. But the year can't come quick enough.
So did you have anything, Jane, that you wanted to bring up?
We discussed this earlier today, and it really does make sense. It's presidential election is not the time to test this out.
You make a good team.
I think, you know, waiting, going from March 2017 to March of 2018 gives us time to prepare for it, too, where, you know, next year it seems like we just go from election to election to election. So it's definitely a better time to do it if we wait one more year.
Good.
Well, thank you for coming in this evening. We appreciate it.
Thank you.
Next, we have Chris Jacobs, DPW Director. And we also have the Deputy.
Jennifer Hale.
Jennifer Hale, Deputy Director of Public Works with me. Have to give Jennifer the credit for having the patience to work through a PowerPoint presentation that we've prepared for you. The agenda also set a bit of a department update, and our department's an open book, and you can see what we've been up to and what we've finished. The High and Lafayette project has wrapped up. That was good to see that a three-year effort of trying to use those FEMA funds finally came to fruition. Interestingly, I was in Les's barbershop the other day, and the ladies were regaling on how their stormwater efforts went in the past. And what it was nice to see is that the community appreciates and understands the need to get some of these projects done. You know, a number of the businesses down there, the Coffee Bean, Kitchen on the Depot Square, they all had to work with the town, and particularly Jen, to get this project done, and they did. And it was it came out really good. Another project that we're very glad that we got to work on is the new sidewalk next between Greg's Pizza and Attorney Zumbo's office. Really, really good partnership between not only the private sector and the public sector. And the real credit goes to John Nyan for, if you will, organizing the whole thing, and Rusty for pushing him, keeping him going in the right direction. But we did our part with the demo and then re-graveling it and getting it ready, doing the things the department could do at little to no cost to us. And Mr. Tinius stepped forward and hired the contractor to put in the pavers. And I think it just really, really looks great. It says a lot about the town. It says a lot about the cooperative effort of what we do together. And from our perspective in Public Works, it's nice to see that. It's nice to see things getting done. You know, you saw the outer section, or saw early this summer Exeter Road followed up by Toll Farm Road. So that's, you know, we're really focused on, if you will, getting things done, solving problems, solving issues. Can't really say we're fond of studying anymore or thinking about it or planning on it or things of that nature, only when it's really truly necessary. But for the most part, we just like moving forward on things and getting them done, bringing them to fruition. With that, I am going to turn this over to Jennifer. As I said, she does has put together a PowerPoint presentation of the warrant articles that have been drawn up and presented. Fully understanding that there's going to be need to be a discussion, a give and take, as to which ones of these you ultimately want to proceed forward on, whether do you want to proceed with them all. We do have a lot of technical information in these ring binders to back it all up. So if you, after the presentation, if you want to start with the questions, that's what we're here for. All right, Jen?
Good to go.
Yeah.
All right. One of the big things to remember as we're going through this, and Chris just mentioned it, I mean, there is a lot here, as you've all seen and you're going to see and hopefully not become overwhelmed. But the idea is to show you that all the projects that we're putting forward are really about how we are part of public safety as the Public Works Department, and how economic growth occurs because of what we do. Found this quote, thought it was quite appropriate. DPWs are not just first responders in emergencies, they also build the long-term emergency infrastructure. So without the infrastructure and our needs that we have to get done, getting these projects done, it makes it harder for everybody else. So really quick, and this was more done for everybody at home or just as more of a general thing, but what our department does and the impact that it has on our community. Basically, you know, our sewer treatment, when you're using the toilets and it's going down the drains, a lot of people out of sight, out of mind. There is this big thing down at the DPW called the wastewater treatment plant that has many parts, components under many regulations, whether it's the DES, the EPA, and there are parts and pumps and all these other aspects that need to be upgraded to meet the standards. This also goes with all our rubbish removal that we do in town, down at the beach, along with the recycling. That also goes on. Basically, when you think of the Department of Public Works and you think of the roadway work we do, we just talked a little bit about the High Street Lafayette Road drainage problems. But when you're building, you know, these roads and you're looking at how stormwater runs on these roads, if it's not done properly or they're not maintained and their potholes are left, not only is that damage to potentially something driving over it, it's damage to the roadway. So this is where you get the hydroplaning, you get the erosion, the potholes, the sinkholes. Again, another reason why what we do at DPW and what you're about to see, we're looking for the support to do these projects. Basically, the goals of the 2016 warrant articles are to secure the funding that we need, and this will help us facilitate the necessary improvements that need to go on. It's also reliability and sustainability of everything here in Hampton. So that goes from the wastewater treatment plants to our highway division, our sewer and drain division. It's our solid waste transfer station. It's our building. It's our vehicles. Tonight, the first ones we're going to start off with are our highway division warrant articles. The first one we have here is for the Seawall Bicentennial Park replacement. I think it's really important to note here, and if you haven't seen it, that this wall is in disarray in certain areas. You can see by the pictures up there, those are actual. The wall has crumbled in spots. There are spots that are still standing. The state took on their project and rebuilt the wall right adjacent to it in the last, it was a year ago or so. And now their wall is taller than our wall. So when you have all these things happening, they're not acting in unison, and there needs to be work done. Originally, when we looked at this, the department looked at this a while back, there was some, you know, beginning study, for lack of words, done. More recently, we have brought in some people to take a look at it and basically go, okay, what's going on with this wall? Is the wall in complete failure? Is sections of the wall in failure? Does the wall have a core and the outside needs repair? There's a lot of pieces to this wall replacement. So by doing this work and looking through the warrant article and to be very upfront about, okay, what does this cost? The idea is to basically, you know, what can we do to strengthen it? It's not only the wall, it's the area in front of the wall, the area behind the wall, the area to the side where the boat launch comes down. So looking at that project as a whole, and then also looking at making the wall as high as the adjacent wall. And then also with the effect of sea rise going on, going, well, we're going to replace it or rebuild it now. Let's get it to those heights because we're not going to have the money to do it again 25 years from now. So what we did is we broke this down into preliminary investigation and design. This year, moving forward and getting that geotechnical information that we need to do a design, to be able to have the company say, all right, it is a full rebuild or it's a replacement or here's what you need to do to make this wall whole again. So the article before you is for $85,000, and it's basically to do the additional investigation, get the survey that's needed that you would need for any design moving forward. It would also include a preliminary design with the cost estimates associated with them, so that if you think about it in the sense of if it's wall replacement, it's demo, it's removing the wall, it's coffer dams, it's setting it up to build it. If it's wall repair, it's a different price. So that's what this first article is about. The second one, and I'm assuming we'll go through the whole thing, or how do you want to handle this?
Yeah, does anyone have any questions about
yeah,
that?
Yeah, maybe we should ask questions as we
as
go
we go
along.
Through. Okay.
Mr. Waddell?
On the wall, I mean, I live right there. I see it all the time. I mean, you got to investigate it and figure out what's going on there, because it looks like a disaster.
Mr. Bridle.
Now, that wall was given to us by the federal government when we got the Coast Guard station back in 1970. Mm-hmm. And really, what have we spent on that wall in the past 50 years?
Zip. To my understanding, not much of anything.
So, I mean, it was a wall. It was, who knows who designed it back then? I mean,
right.
Seeing some of the old pictures I have of the Coast Guard station, I'm sure it was put together by some well-intentioned people, but we don't know how it was designed, and we won't know that unless you actually get by and do this. So I think we really do need to do the study to at least find out what we need to do, because it's not going to get any better. It's only going to get worse. So,
Mrs. Wellesley.
You're talking about an engineering study?
It's an engineering study, but it goes back to what Chris said when we opened. This is not just the study. It's the study and the next step. What are the costs?
Right.
Do we have to rebuild it, or can we repair it?
What I'm getting at is, would this be bid out for the services of whoever
yes.
is
going to? We would go out for an RFQ to select a consultant.
Okay. This is what someone in insurance would call an attractive nuisance. There's a great potential for somebody, especially kids, to get hurt over there. I agree that you need to do it, and it's smart to do it this way and make sure you're on solid ground, understanding what you have to deal with. So I like the idea, and the $85,000, best guess for... I mean, I'm sure you can't get down to the last nickel, but in line with engineering costs these days, you figure that would cover you?
This would be for the survey, the mm-hmm. geotechnical study, mm-hmm. the preliminary design, which looks at height, depth, length yeah. of footings, the armor stone that would need to go before, looking at the support that you need to put both, basically put the whole conceptual plan together. Okay. Yes, in here, though, in this last sentence, and I didn't read it, and I apologize. There's also small money in here for immediate repairs. There are some areas in there that really, while we're going through this process, should yep. be shored up.
This may be kind of stupid, but could you fence in the whole area and say, don't go here, put a big sign and say...
You can fence here. It in for people, but I think what we're really concerned about is a major winter storm coming
yeah.
in,
okay.
demolishing the thing and it caving literally into the,
okay.
the ocean.
And I have one question for Fred. Now, we have a problem with the state getting a permit to do this?
No, the state will support us in this.
You think we will be?
Yeah. They recognize this is a problem for their wall if we don't
okay.
fix this wall.
Not that I doubt the state's cooperation.
Of course not.
Thank you.
Mr. Bean.
No questions.
And I don't have any questions at this time.
Okay.
I guess we'll go on to the second one.
The second one we have in here is the Road Improvement Capital Reserve Fund. The current balance of the Capital Reserve Fund as of December of last year was $633,000. This fund is more for the long-term improvements. My understanding, it's been going, it's been approved the last few years. This bond is for the, excuse me, this article is for the $300,000 to be put into the fund. And basically, when this board, you know, seems, you know, the time is right, this is a fund that would be used for those capital improvements for the roadways.
Questions, Mr. Waddell?
It should be noted, at the end of December, it'll actually be like 933.
Yes, we did another 300 last year, yeah.
So it's the same as we did last year?
Correct, yes.
Okay, yeah, all set.
We've been doing it just about every year since 1998, when the fund was established, but prior board stripped down on it. This is the kind of thing we want in place so that we can fund the Exeter Road when it comes to the big reworking. This is very valuable, and I think it's a great idea.
Mr. Bean?
No questions.
Thank you.
The next one that we have here is the Highway Block Grant. This is the money that was set aside. This is the money that allowed us to be able to do Fairfield, Ruth, Belmont, Toll Farm Road, the crack sealing that is planned. It's money that is set aside to put to our roadways to get them repaired. We did look at the roadways in the order of which ones potentially for next year. I do have the caveat on the screen, and I'll say it out loud. You know, depending on how they go through the winter season, the orders change. These are roads that we are looking at. You can see from those two pictures, Landing Road and Richard Street are definitely in need of repair. So on this list, we're anticipating Landing Road, Old Stage Road, Acorn, Watson, and Richard. And this is what this block grant would be used for.
And so the block grant is how much? So
the block grant is estimated to be about $299,000. So it would be a tax impact of $343,424.
Questions? Mr. Waddell?
Not right now.
Mr. Bridle?
This highway block grant, that's money that comes from the state for class 5 roads in our towns.
Yes.
That's paid for through gas tax. Correct. Right. So this is just money that we get for working on our roads. We just have to approve it at town meeting, correct?
Right. So the total is $643,299 roughly is from the gas tax. The rest would be from general taxes. Okay. We've got, if I can just read off quickly the roads that are under consideration for this amount of money. Landing Road, Old Stage Road, Acorn Road, Driftwood Road, Mary Batchelder, Watson Lane, Richard Street, Briar Road, Forest Drive, and Cedar View Lane. And we're reserving $60,000 for milling and patching certain roads in certain areas. For instance, Lock Road in the area where it meets Brad Street is really rough. Also, $30,000 for crack sealing. So that's where that $643,000 would be spent.
Now, did we get more money from the state when they?
Yeah, it's gone from like 267 when it started to this two. We're estimating 299.
Okay.
That's a state figure.
What's that?
That's a state figure, the 299.
And did you want to continue?
So that's that, this that. One on the block grant. The next one
We going around? What are we doing?
Yeah, I thought you already commented.
On the block grant?
Okay, do you want to comment?
Yes. But I don't want to, if you want to do the gentleman first.
We're all set.
No, but we better went.
Okay. Yeah. The state's highway block grant funding to us this calendar year was $267,649. We've got $6,402 left. Do you think that will be left by December 31st so that you can piggyback that? It's not much money, but $6,000 to $6,000.
Yeah, that was designated for crack sealing, and the crack sealing contractor is that's how he's going to get everything done.
Okay.
So we may, in all likelihood, be encumbering that money to the spring.
Okay. Now, Jen didn't have all the streets. Mary Batchelder was one that I was going to ask about because you mentioned last year that that was one that was certainly in need of. I agree with doing this only if we stipulate the roads and you're pretty firm on what roads you really think you need to do. In years past, you probably remember, Rusty will remember certainly, that we listed 10, 12, 14, whatever, roads, and some of them never got done, and that makes the public really cross. So if you have your, if you have your sights set on five roads, eight roads that you really, really want to do, then I strongly suggest we put the roads in the article. People will be far more inclined to vote for that article if they see specifics. There, that's my speech.
Can I answer that?
Yes.
Serious enough that I put together these packets, if you want to see them, of actual estimates for those roads that I announced.
Yep.
That's how serious I am about it.
Good.
The only caveat that I would say is I look for you people to hold me to this list, and maybe the taxpayers do too, because when I do bid this work out, you're the ones would have to approve the contract. So you're the ones that could hold my feet to the fire, per se. I'm not as fond of putting the actual street names, or at least all of them, in the Warren article, because in a previous community I worked in, we literally had a road that did not make it through the winter and had to go back to the powers to be to say, can we take off XYZ road and go to this one, because it literally went to a Jeep trail due to the heavy truck traffic during the winter. So things can happen during the winter. Mm-hmm. I don't know how difficult this winter is going to be. So, you know, if we get a winter with, you know, totally opposite of last year with no snow, but the frost goes down 4 feet, it could really decimate some roads.
Yeah. Well, just if I asked you earlier this year,
mm-hmm.
You know, when we were getting, when you were doing the article for 2015, what if, because Belmont, Fairfield, and Ruth had to be done.
Correct.
And I said to you, what if you have a little money left over? And you said, well, and you weren't fooling around with it. You said it right out. I'd like to do Mary Batchelder because there's no underpinning, no sewer, no utilities. So it would be an easy road to do, and it's in bad shape.
Mm-hmm.
So if we could do that, if you could focus on, say, the top three roads
yeah.
that you really are dedicated to doing, and then if you have money left over and can do some of the others, people will be happy. But right. I think it will help people tremendously if they can see some focus.
Right. I
you
say
know,
you're
we not go. Not use up all the money on the first three roads.
We put the top three then in the right. article if
yeah.
you want. That's fine
yeah.
with me.
Because I think people are far more inclined to vote for it.
Mr. Bean,
no comment.
Would you, and you like to move on to the?
Yes, please.
So the next article we have is for sidewalks. These are actual sidewalks here in Hampton. It is one of the items that. Before my time, and I don't know, maybe before yours, there was a whole sidewalk study done, and that study identified and inventoried every single sidewalk we have in town, and basically set it on a path to repair. Well, on top of that, we have ADA compliance regulations that have to be made and improved, and to do this, there's, you know, more in here than what could be done in our operating budget. So this is why you'll see this article's asking for $45,650 to be specifically applied to sidewalks, ADA compliance, repair, and replacement. On top of the ADA, we have many sidewalks that don't meet the width requirement. So there's a lot more than just putting in the concrete. There's some replanning, those type of things. So that is what this one is all about.
Questions?
Yeah, I agree. The sidewalks in Hampton are terrible. I mean, it's dangerous. I mean, it's awful.
Mm-hmm.
And do you have to be ADA if you don't? Mm-hmm. You have to change it in order to be ADA, or do you have to?
We have many that need to be brought to the current standard of ADA requirements.
Right. And if they're not at ADA, it's required that you do it.
Yeah.
Yes,
it's
over
not,
a certain time frame. No.
What's the time frame?
My understanding is 2000. And I could be confusing something else. I might want to get back to you on that one.
Okay.
Yeah, let me get back to you on that.
The risks are always ongoing in that the Americans with Disabilities Act gave anybody who felt they were aggrieved by the policy or the lack of compliance with the policy to step in and take on municipality, a private corporation, a private site. So the risk is current and it's real. Our situation has developed over years of it's some of these sidewalks, it's the way they've always been. For instance, if you look in the area of TD Bank, there's a crosswalk there. There's no ADA compliant ramp on either end.
Right.
So most communities handled it on a road by road, case by case basis. Been making some effort, and that's been considered, if you will, a genuine attempt to comply with the law. And we're just trying to be a little bit more compliant with the law because we have some real stickers out there as far as things that need to get done.
100%.
So,
Mr. Bridle.
Now I'm going to ask you, as your tree warden hat on,
yep.
We have a number of sidewalks in town that have a tree between the sidewalk and the street. And over the year, those trees have gotten much bigger. Mm-hmm. And what they've done is they've heaved the sidewalk. And I'm thinking one in particular is over by Marston School in front of the Hobbs House.
Yep.
That one there, the sidewalk in there has got through. What do we do in those cases? Do we take the tree down? Do we, you know, I know it's kind of a little bit off this, but
no,
I see that sidewalk there, and that's one of the potential, you know, it's a trip hazard.
They do and some other sidewalk projects I've done in the past where we're rebuilding them and they're on town city roads. One of the first things we try to do is you can actually do root trimming. So you can go around and depending on the tree, and I am by far not the tree warden or a tree expert, so I probably should have let you do that one. But it just didn't pass practice. There are sometimes you can do that. I mean, these trees, they don't stop growing.
Right.
And the sidewalk went in way back when. Mm-hmm. That tree was not that big.
Right.
So there's ways to do it. There's ways to go around it. Depends on your right-of-way. I mean, they're case-by-case basis, literally.
Mm-hmm. Well, I know we have a lot of sidewalks in this town, and for too many years, we haven't done much to them. And you're absolutely right. There are a number of the ADA-compliant ones.
Mm-hmm.
So I think it's time we start looking at that.
Okay.
How much money did we ask for last year for the sidewalks?
$26,000. Same thing we've asked every year.
All right. So I went back and looked at, like you said, there's in the operating budget the sidewalk line. Then I went back into the sidewalk management area, and if you look at what was proposed to be spent in 2014, 15, and 16. 14, 26,000, 15, 19,000, 16, 26,000. You could add this money to the operating money and get caught up. Granted, that's staff time, got to get it all done. And some of this would not be staff, I'd imagine. There's different ways we can handle it. I don't want to say one way or another, but it's just a lot of work to do.
Mrs. Wolseley.
Currently, at the end of October 2015, we have $20,018 left in the sidewalk account. 2012, we had $21,945 left. 2013, we had $25,468 left. This is as of December 30th. 2014, $26,000, the whole thing was left. And 2015, it was $24,758 when I looked it up. Right now it's $20,000 and change. Not only have we not reconstructed sidewalks, and the sidewalk on Toll Avenue is a disgrace, among others, but we have put in concrete sidewalks. I like them much better than the hot top sidewalks, but nobody's sealing them, ever.
Mm-hmm.
And all the money we've spent in the concrete sidewalks is down the rabbit hole. And this is a real sore point with me. I don't know if you can retrieve the money from prior years, in the prior budgets. I didn't think that's gone. But and I don't think there's a way to carry over this year. If we're really, really going to do it, number one, I'd suggest we take the sidewalk money in the operating budget down to a dollar, keep the line open. And if we're going to get this, okay, if we're really serious about doing the sidewalks and including sealing in that whole enterprise. Do we need to do it? Yes. But I'm crossing my fingers.
Mr. Bean.
No comment.
And would you be planning on making them concrete or?
If they're all, in certain neighborhoods where they're already concrete, I would, again, make them concrete. For instance, Toll Ave is one that we.
Mill Road.
That we've considered ripping out and just replacing. To get this done to ensure that it gets done, the two methodologies that we're going to use is we hired a contractor outside of Town Hall here. I made basically all three divisions work together. First sewer and drain demoed it. Then I got the carpenters to work with a mason that I hired to install the concretes and finish them. And it was actually a training session for them, and they bought $1,000 worth of tools out of it to get it done in the future. So now they freely admit to themselves, or to me, that, hey, we now think we can handle a straight section of sidewalk. So we're prepared to do it in-house, and then you saw the paving where we didn't replace the sidewalk got done by the highway division. I mean, it's similar to the Greg sidewalk story where multiple people took on their share of the work, and we got it done. If we have too much other type of work next year to get it done, what I would do is just hire it out, bid it out, so not big enough so that it would attract a contractor. And we'd like to put this 46 with that other 26, then it would probably be a big enough chunk that it would attract contractors. And as far as the sealing goes, we put in the contract that they have to return within 1 year and seal the contracts and hold a certain percentage of money back. Then it would be a breach contract if they don't do it then.
And one more quick one, Mr. Chairman, if I may. The sidewalk on the north side of High Street from Five Corners East was bad. There was an accident and a young woman was killed a number of years ago on a winter evening, and everybody got together and hollered for the sidewalk. It was installed. I think it cost us around $250,000. That was a good while ago. As far as I know, it's never been sealed. But now I'm assuming that that's ADA compliant, because when they first put it in, I thought it was a little weird because it goes down and up and down and up.
Probably is. Yeah, that one is.
But I think very few people walk on it. But that's probably a classic example of something that should have been sealed and has never been.
Mr. Bean.
No questions.
No. Okay. And do you have a?
All right. The next one, this one is a warrant article for three new DPW employees. In my first few months here, I am in awe of how much the staff actually takes on and how much they do and what happens when one person is not there from one division or two people are not there from one division and the balance that has to be done between general roadway work. One of the things I've actually heard from in here as well, maybe watching on TV, is that we have many staff that have had many years of service with us. And with that many years of service comes many years of knowledge, of the streets, our drains, our sewers, and how the DPW operates. So before these people decide, you know what, I've put in my service and it's time to go, the idea to be able to train new employees with their expertise is one of the biggest reasons besides the actual need for new employees. My middle bullet here is basically, if you think of DPW, we have an intense summer and we have an intense winter, and it leaves a few weeks in the middle between each of those to get everything else done. And when you look at the circles on the right, I mean, that's a very general overview of what DPW does. From the highway department, and that's the highway department alone. So the last bullet here is just, it's basically our responsibilities have been exceeded by our current labor capacity. So what this warrant article is asking for is three new DPW employees for the highway department at a total cost of $145,924. This is for the 39 weeks, so this is after meeting into December, so then after that, the cost would increase for those other months.
Mr. Waddell.
Wow. I mean, you know, you see the need, and you see that, but I don't know, adding employees right now is just really tough, and you add benefits, and you add insurance, and I mean, but I can see the need, but I just don't know.
Mr. Bridle.
It is tough to see that need, but about any of our departments here, I think Public Works is the one that's really undermanned. And you know, Mary Louise talks about the sidewalks not being done and over the past number of years. Well, part of that was that we had default budgets and that money went to other places, but other parts of it are they didn't have the manpower to do it.
Mm-hmm.
And so, you know, this is a kind of a tough pill, but I do agree with you that I think that DPW is severely undermanned right now. And it's going to be a tough one to get through the voters, but I think they see it too. I think they see all the work that's being done in town too. So we need to let the voters have the choice of see what they want to do.
I would agree.
Mrs. Wellesley.
Well, well, well. Not only are we getting individuals who are more experienced because they've been with us, many of them, for a very long time, but they're getting older. And one of these days, we're going to start losing more of them. And the experience that they're going to take with them is invaluable. We really need to start understudying. What has the biggest impact on your ability to do what you need to do in public works, Chris?
It's the less obvious tasks that, when they don't get done repeatedly year after year, tend to pinch you later on. For instance, when I had sewer and drain help on the sidewalk, that meant that they weren't
right.
Cleaning catch basins,
right.
Jetting drainage lines, videotaping, or mm-hmm. inspecting sewer lines. Mm-hmm. So there's always it's a trade-off. And I think that's what we've been doing in the past, is a lot of trading off. Just last week, how we're impacted is one of the newer sidearm packers is down. Needs a $3,000 pump.
Mm-hmm.
It's sitting over at Seabrook truck. I won't yep. sign the requisition because I'm under a budget constraint. Yep. So to accomplish even trash removal, two guys moved out of highway to the back end of one of the packers to throw bags in. We went back to the Emmanuel method. And that puts a strain on the rest of the department mm-hmm. to the point that Frank last week, he's like, finally, beg and borrow one guy from, let's say, wastewater, who used to be in highway, he and himself, and they went out and they paved and patched. Frank's not a young man anymore. He's 63. It strains him to do that kind of work for an eight-hour day. But to his credit, he went to that level. And he used a 70-year-old guy to help him. And I forget, and thankfully he had two younger guys. So that's what we're getting to, is we've got a combination of, like you say, older, experienced people, but also just not enough people, not enough hands.
Where do you reach the breaking point on trash?
Well, we never do, because trash has a priority over cleaning drains, cleaning basins, cutting the grass at the landfill, yeah. Trimming back phragmites. It's a priority task, just like snow removal. So something else won't get done if it has to get done.
Have you kept any records on the volume of trash and the relative increase over the past 5 years, 10 years? Anybody kept a record, do you know?
Yeah, we do. But it's very cyclical with weather and because of the beach and the economy. So you really, it's tough to take tonnage and track it to, let's say, population.
Right. No, it's a problem, and I know you need more manpower, and it's killing us with this retirement and medical and stuff. I don't know if some of that's going to be remedied by the feds on the medical and by the state on the retirement, but I don't hold up out much hope.
Mr. Bean?
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Director, you have a note here. It's actually going to be very close to $200,000.
Right.
For three people. Does that include all the benefits?
I believe it does. That was a number that we worked out with the finance director.
Includes the benefits.
Includes all benefits?
Yep.
Thank you.
Yeah. For myself, I I'm in favor of probably more things being bid out in the future rather than depending on extra employees to accomplish this. I'm questioning whether there could be people that are hired that aren't hired full-time just to make sure that they're the type, you know, that they have the potential to be a full-time employee in the future. But myself, I don't think I'm in favor of more employees. Did you want to the next one?
We can move to the next one. The next one here is a warrant article for a reserve fund for unusual weather. Basically, I think last winter may have spoken for this whole slide, but it's not just snow. We have an experience often coastal flooding. We have many surrounding towns and communities and within the county where roads have washed away. That just takes significant cost and effort. And, you know, you take a big hit when it's time to just fix those on the spot. So this is a warrant article that's been set up to cover manpower and overtime, the resources and equipment, repairs and replacement. It would be money that would be applied to the projects that are identified through the community process, but would be approved by the Board of Selectmen.
Mr. Waddell?
Yeah, I agree with this one. I mean, I think this is better than paying for an insurance premium every year. I think you're self-insuring. You're building up a fund that you can use when you have an emergency-type situation, a situation like last year. You don't have to go looking for the money. So, yeah, I'm with this one.
Mr. Bridle?
Yeah, I'm for this, too. I can think of back a number of years ago when the culvert got washed out on Winneconnet Road, and it shut Winneconnet Road down for 4 or 5 months because of the went through there. And so it's not just snowstorms. It could be any type of storm. And we have a lot of culverts in this town that have needed work for a long time. We lost a fire truck in one 4 or 5 years ago up on Five Corners.
Yeah,
you know,
4 or 5 years.
Well, yeah, I guess it was 8 or 10 years ago. Yeah. But yeah, but there's all that work that's out there, and things do happen, and you can't plan for everything. But this is an insurance policy to help when that does happen. So,
Mr. Welch, where did the money come from when the culvert went down on?
It was before Fred.
Winneconnet Road.
Yes.
Oh, I wasn't here at the time, but
I believe. I want to say that they got money from
some
another
of that was
source.
State. Yeah, state some of that was
or
state.
Federal or
yep.
something.
Probably FEMA.
FEMA. Something. It came from another location. It wasn't just from the town. Mm-hmm. Mrs. Wolseley.
I'm opposed to this. I don't want to see any more funds. We're supposed to be holding a minimum of 5% in the undesignated fund balance, and that's where we should go for something unusual. I can't support this.
Mr. Bean.
No comment.
And next.
So the next warrant articles are related to the sewer and drain division. Mm-hmm. The first one we have here is the High Street Culvert at Meadow Pond and the drainage study. This is not new. This is about replacing monies that are no longer available to us from the state. So this is for the project that is the culvert out below the grist mill. It's basically the culvert that connects Mill Pond and Meadow Pond. To get this project all done, we're going to need the federal and state permits. It's also going to require a drainage study to show what the impact is at Mill Pond. And over the years, there's been a lot of sediment and fill and how this is all going to work once it's replaced. Basically, this warrant article will amend the 2014 warrant article. In that article specifically, it indicated that there was, I believe, $147,500 identified in state funds that are no longer available to us. So this warrant article has an $87,000 taxed impact, where $60,500 is proposed to come from the undesignated general fund balance. So basically, the total is making up the part that is no longer available from the state, split between the tax impact and the undesignated fund.
And this is one that was turned down last year, right?
This was approved last year.
It was approved.
It was. And it was approved with that language.
It was approved in 2014.
2014. And it was approved with specific language relative to that $147,500 coming from the state. So now that that's not available, it needs to be funded differently.
Now, why is the $147,000 no longer available?
That's a part I can't remember, too.
You're not breaching the dam. You're replacing it. And if you look at the study that was done by the engineering firm, it doesn't matter whether you replace the dam or you breach the dam. The culvert system that's there now is not big enough to take the load of water going right through that system and will, in fact, flood the roadway and eventually wash it out.
And there was never an engineering study done before?
Not on the culverts.
Not on the culverts,
right.
Just on the dam?
Right.
So if the one for the dam hadn't passed, would the 147 still be, if we had removed the dam, would the 147 still be
it would
available?
It would have been provided by the state to do the study and to improve the culverts. But since it wasn't passed, because it was amended by a subsequent article, the money was taken away.
Because they decided not to take the dam down.
Right.
Then you lose the 147 because they were going to keep
it. It's not that they decided.
The town decided.
We decided. That's yeah. They. That's they.
We. No, we were directed.
Words there.
We were directed by the town to take the dam down, and we didn't do it. And then you had the subsequent article.
The article, right.
Right.
Mr. Brill.
Is there any, do you foresee any future state of federal funds?
Not for new dams or rebuilding the dams. We were alerted to this almost 3 years ago, that all the money that's out there from, let's say, a Sierra Club or the Rivers Conservancy or Trout Unlimited is all for removing dams and allowing water to return to its natural course.
Yes.
And that's the ideology, if you will, that's out there today. So all the people from the state with Fish and Game and Wetlands Bureau and Dam Bureau that all sat and helped us through that process warned us multiple times that there was only money in there for removal.
Okay. Thank you.
Yep. That's
true. Mrs. Walsley.
This one really gets my goat. We were given permission by the public to decommission that dam in 2014. The grant was available. I don't know why we were taxed on that, because nothing was done with it that year. I don't know whether the proposed culvert in this warrant article will meet the specifications that the culvert in conjunction with decommissioning that dam would have. I'm not an engineer. I don't know what this culvert vis-a-vis some other culvert would accomplish. We've lost the grant, and we're still sitting here almost 2 years later not doing what the public told us to do. It floods down at the end of High Street all the time. DES allowed building of those buildings in the marsh at the east end of High Street, and that's a continuing drainage problem. I'm not going to support anything associated with putting a culvert in there until somebody makes up their mind one way or the other what we're going to do about that dam and get it over with. Sitting here for 2 years, come March, when the public voted and directed us to take an action, and we did not do it. So I don't want to hear about culverts. I don't want to hear anything about the dam until we move and do what the public directed us to do, period.
Mr. Bean.
Mr. Welch, you say if this isn't done, there's a potential that the road could be ruined?
It's been years. It's
no, the road could disappear.
Okay.
That's the difference. Actually, when we look at, it doesn't matter whether you replace the dam with by taking it down or whether you replace the dam by building a new one. The amount of water running through there at peak level, at peak flow, is going to surcharge the roadway and surcharge the culverts and run over the road. It's
yes.
going to exceed the capacity. And the issue with that is the same as if the dam, you had a dam there and it breached. Part of the problem with not removing the dam and not taking an action on that, frankly, was because we had no way of knowing, the engineering report wasn't complete, and there was no way of providing the finished product by removing hundreds of thousands of cubic yards of muck behind that dam in order to get it, in order to bring the dam down, and no one had permission to do that. And we couldn't get permission to do that. So it's not a simple matter. If you take the dam down, you're going to have to remove hundreds of thousands of cubic yards mm-hmm. of muck, and it's going to have to be pumped onto somebody's land and dried. Nobody wants to do that. And then it can be removed when it's dry. There's a whole series of problems here that we're working on trying to get this finished, and probably in the next few months you're going to see us moving towards fixing that dam, because the money is there and we've been working towards that process now for some time. So the problem is, regardless of what you do with the dam, whether you take it down or whether you build it up, you've got a problem on High Street, and if we have another Mother's Day storm, High Street's not going to be there. That's the problem.
It's been the same since Rad K put those buildings
in there.
It floods every year.
No, it's not the buildings. This is actually the roadway.
Mrs. Walsley.
Thank you for shedding some light on that, Mr. Welch. I'm all set, Mr. Chairman.
Continue, please.
The next one we have here under the Sewer and Drain Division is Kings Highway Drainage. This is just a small picture showing a portion of the problem that's down there. Kings Highway is very flat. What's great about this area, if I could say it, is that we do have an old sewer collection system down there and pump station. And part of this plan would be to actually facilitate and use that infrastructure to help solve the drainage problems down in this area. So basically, you know, having the drainage problems, you know, one, it deteriorates the road, but two, in the summer, you know, we have a problem as people are trying to avoid the puddles. They're, you know, dodging pedestrians, which seems odd, but it's real. And in the winter, these puddles are freezing, causing ice slicks. So it's really a safety concern. So this warrant article is asking for $50,000 to go through that process of design and reuse the sewer system. And it is asterisked because this is undesignated general fund balance. There would be no tax impact for this year.
Mr. Waddell.
Obviously a problem. See it all the time. Every time, even the littlest rain there is, or super high tide. Something that should have been dealt with a long time ago.
It was for, what was it, a $2 million or was it more that was spent down there?
That was for sewer.
That was for sewer.
That was for sewer. They should have put the drain in at the same time, but they didn't.
As long as we keep building in wet areas.
So, any other questions, Mr. Bridle?
That area has been built for over 70 to 100 years.
Yeah, that's
so
wet.
It's been a wet area, we know that. I think this makes a lot of sense to use that old line that's there. So you can get rid of that water. make it safer for the people. And I have no problem with this.
So this is for the actual work?
This would be the preliminary design work.
Just for the preliminary design?
Yeah, this is the design work.
Oh, this is design work.
Just design.
It's taking it because there's still pump design that would go on, figure out where the catch basins have to go, fine grading, obviously, to get the water to flow to it.
The old sewer line that we would use, we'd essentially connect catch basins to an old sewer line, drain that water back to that pump station. That only covers one half of King's Highway. The other half, from the pump station up to, let's say, Green Street, would still need a series of basins. I think my memory's correct. I figured about 8 basins or sets in the pipe in between. So there is some physical.
Are you aware of why this wasn't done before? Was it money? How much was that Warren article that went that time? Was it $2 million or $4 million? I think it was $2 million.
Well, and if you got state aid for it, it could have only been used for the sewer. It still couldn't have been used for the stormwater. That would have had to come out of the taxpayers'
so
pockets.
So this wasn't done because there wasn't enough money at the time?
Right, it just wasn't envisioned.
No. Mrs. Wolseley?
No.
Mr.
No, sir.
Continue,
moving on,
please.
On where do we go? This is the Warren article is related to DPW vehicles. This first one that we have is for the purchase of a Snow-Go type snowblower. Basically, this is what would save us a lot of time and work on these very large snowbanks that we've been experiencing, getting them loaded onto trucks and out of there. Basically, I think those pictures right there sort of show you the heights of snowbanks that we had to remove and the fact that you get someone down there having to load it on a truck. This would be something that would just load it directly to the truck. Basically, it could be used on sidewalks, it could be used in parking lots, it could be used along the roadway. It doesn't have limitations in that sense. When I say that, you wouldn't be seeing it going down a sidewalk. That's what sidewalks are for, sidewalk plows are for. But it would remove those big piles that cause the sightline interference and some of the many other safety problems that we've had. This is for $125,000, and that would be an actual purchase of the snowblower.
So did we have something like this before?
Not of this size.
Not of this size.
Okay. Mr. Waddell?
Would this be something that you could hire somebody with a piece of equipment like that to do, or is it?
Well, we've.
Would there be a savings there if you were to hire somebody, you know, bring in a contractor to do that rather than purchasing it?
Yeah, we've asked. Peter Rice in Portsmouth has two. We asked to borrow his. We'd pay certainly the labor rate. He saw it as very problematic of sending it, getting it disassembled, hauled down the road, and by the time he got here, be a day late and a dollar short. We reached out to contractors like Jamco that we've used in the past, and they said, basically, if you want us to invest $125,000, then we'll expect you to lease it or hire it on an annual basis, regardless of whether it snows or not. Then if it works, then we bill you, then if it does snow, we'll bill you at X dollars per hour. It wasn't going to be cheap. Essentially, in two seasons, you'd end up buying this outright. The advantage to it would be if we had it in-house, that when instead of going back and just winging snowbanks back, we'd actually take the front blade or the side blades off the wings off the trucks and start loading our own trucks and doing our own hauling Monday through Friday rather than what we did last winter. If we could, you know, as we reach 30 or 40 inches of snow in a season, we just start to get rid of the snowbanks. It would give us the capacity when we do have a 30-inch event to put the snow somewhere. What we ran into was when we had the 30-inch event, we had no room. So there'll be a year, I'll tell you, the thing won't even move because we, you know, 2 years ago we didn't get enough snow to shovel. But last year we got made up for it. So there will be times. The other thing is if you rent one, you have to rent a mechanic with it because they're very mechanical. They need to be adjusted. They need to be lubricated. They're a very labor-intensive piece of equipment. Good thing is they can load out a dump truck in about 3 or 4 minutes. you couldn't get enough trucks in front of it to keep it churning along.
If we went back over a number of years, can we figure out how many years we would use it? You know, how many years we would have used, you know, how many years we had that much snow that we would have used rather than...
We can do that, yeah.
I mean, I think that would be important that if it's only, you know, I mean, last year was an exceptional year.
Right.
And how many exceptional years are we going to have?
Right.
That's my thoughts.
Mr. Bridle.
And I know we spent a lot of money hauling snow last year. How much do we actually spend loading that snow? Do we have that figure?
Well, I put it all down as loading because it was 325,000.
Right.
Five payloaders and 12 triaxles. So the triaxles were loading it down the road, if you will. But we
leased five loaders last year.
And then on top of that, we had a large excavator down on top of the pile creating mount, whatever hasn't been named yet, at $350 an hour. So that was expensive.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Before we get to vote on, because I don't think we'll be doing it tonight, but on these warrant articles, I'd like to see your list of priorities, how you prioritize okay. these. Mrs. Wolseley.
The big advantage to having this in-house is to cleaning the areas adequately. When we use a sidewalk plow, you've got a lump from the street over here, and then the sidewalk plow comes along, and there's a lump over here, and then people are walking on ice, basically, as the snow melts in the very unsafe sidewalks. And I don't think sidewalk plows are too great anyway. I think in concept, I really like this. If Chris can give us an idea, as you requested, on how frequently we would use it, this is certainly smarter than diddling along with little tiny sidewalk plows, and the sidewalks aren't any better than they were with snow on them.
Mr. Bean.
No questions.
And please continue.
So the next article we have under the vehicles are the three vehicles that we are looking to replace under this warrant article. The first one is Unit 36. It's a Chevy 1-ton with a plow and wing. Unit 45 is a 1988 Mack six-wheel dump truck with plow and wing. And the other one is Unit 42. It's the 1990 Mack with plow and wing. Basically, what's wrong with the existing truck? If we want to start, that bottom right-hand corner is the bottom floor with a, what was that, a Swiffer you
That's
put through there?
Fuller Brushman
brush.
What?
It's a brush. It's showing that there is a hole in the bottom of the floor.
Yeah.
Just trying to identify it so you can actually see that it goes through. The last 3 years of maintenance, we've spent $3,200. It has electrical issues. Repairs to the steering column are needed. Basically, the vehicle is sidelined right now. It is not being used because it's unable to pass inspection. The rocker panels also need to be replaced, and the four-wheel drive is not working. So having the plow...
Top photo is one that I took, and that's the actual transfer case transmission connected to the rest of the drive shaft. One of the bolts is snapped right out of the housing. The other one unthreaded itself. And we know that there was another two loose on the other side that the camera couldn't pick up. So that's why this thing's been parked since probably June. Wouldn't let it go down the road. Knowing that it was a tough budget, I just couldn't see putting the several thousand more dollars into this, not until I was reasonably sure I might even have it, or I might need. This would have been a spare piece of equipment for when we have a breakdown. We would have taken the driver, just put him in this, put him back out on the road, so we don't have a spare 1-ton. There is no backup for this year's snow removal. At present.
What's the next one?
Basically, this is still talking about the Chevy 1-ton, and Chris just said it all. I mean, we don't have the backup. It can't be used for plowing anymore, and the maintenance costs are just going to continue to increase. When you talk about the replacement of Unit 42, 42 is the 1990 Mack six-wheel truck. This truck is one of the first ones that goes out. It's needed to salt and plow. It's the first truck out of the yard. The last 3 years of maintenance have been about $8,000. In the last year alone, it's needed tie rods, the wheels have been replaced, and it needed transmission work. Not transmission replacement, but it's been needing some transmission work. The pictures that you're looking at here are the steps. And the pictures, unfortunately, just really don't do it justice. Those steps are barely attached to the frame, and when they wobble, it winds up hitting other parts. The top picture is one of the air filters in the whole line system. What follows this is unit 45, which is the 1988 Mac. This one is the oldest truck in the fleet. It is also sent first out on the road, salt and plows. It's had about $6,000 worth of maintenance in the last 3 years. And most recently, the wheels, the rear leaf springs, the blower and brakes have all had to been replaced. There is significant rust on this one. If you were to look up underneath it, you'd be challenged to find a spot that isn't. Basically, you know, the question is asked, well, why replace them instead of repairing them? These vehicles are 25 and 27 years old. They are tired, they are used, they have been put back together. And the maintenance costs are going to continue to increase, and the parts are going to be harder to find. So with that said, this warrant article is for all three trucks, the plows and blades, at $353,000. All three vehicles assess some form of trade-in value, and we would look to do that to counter.
Mr. Waddell.
Did we talk about replacing these last year? Or
these are the
same three vehicles.
Year prior to that, were they talked about, or?
They were discussed, but they were not on the, we didn't ask to replace those.
Right, so they've been coming up for a while.
This will be their second year on the ballot, or hopefully on the ballot.
And I mean, looking at, you know, maintaining or repairing, is we figure is more costly or.
Well, I mean, for instance, 42, earlier this summer, they went to put gravel in it because we're relocating the sand pile, taking it from one location, putting it more closer to the salt pile so we can make mix better, enhance our winter operations. They went to put a load in it, and they noticed that the bed was no longer welded or connected to the frame. So they called in White, left it up, called in White's Welding, and basically had him re-weld the cross members back to the bed. The bed was going to slide off.
If it hadn't been from the block, the bed would have slid off.
The second truck, within a week, same thing. There's a hinge point on the back end of the box. The left one was gone. It was, the hinge itself was there and attached, but what it got welded to, the I-beam running up, the I-beam was not there. So they basically cut that out and put a new section of I-beam in and re-welded it. So we're literally down to gluing these trucks back together, even, you know, we are using them during the summer. But we're finding these are constant issues.
And I mean, we've had a plan in effect, right, to replace things as we go along, and we just haven't followed that plan.
Well, the plan of attrition is well in effect. This will make Unit 24, which is Bobby Walker's truck, the utility service, sewer and drain utility truck, got replaced earlier this year because we still had money left in a older CIP for vehicle maintenance. That was the fourth one that was attached to this article last year. These are the same three. They're not getting any less expensive to maintain, and part of the other issue is the truck that's sitting over at Seabird Truck, $3,000. If I spend $3,000 on that hydraulic pump, I don't have it to spend on these, and those trucks are less than 3 years of age, and that's the second hydraulic pump to go this year. So we've gotten more equipment, i.e. the three Packer trucks and additional rear Packer. We've gotten more, in six trailers, we have more equipment to maintain with as much of a less of a budget. And the equipment's getting older and older and older. My fear is these are the frontline trucks. When all these two trucks have Sanders in them. When the call comes out early in the morning, these are the six trucks that leave the shop first. These are the guys that have to answer in the middle of the night, February that melted during the day, the temperature dropped, 2 o'clock in the morning. When they call, these are the trucks that go out. My concern is where these are the very frontline trucks, there's going to be a time they won't be there to do what needs to get done. It will take just longer to salt the roads and longer to clear them.
Mr. Bridle.
No, I think they need to be replaced. I think they've outlived their usefulness. They've served this town well. But at 25 and 27 years old, dealing with snow, not being parked inside or washed down like they have should have been over the years, those vehicles are used and abused, and it is time to replace it.
Mm-hmm.
This is a classic example of our failure to take care of the equipment by making sure that we had some means to wash down the big trucks. You're sitting on $5,113,540 worth of equipment in this department. I understand where you're coming from, but I absolutely refuse to authorize one more vehicle until and unless we have a complete inspection of all the vehicles in your department. You've got the old sludge truck still rotting down there. When I first came back on the board in 2013, you had three or four or five vehicles parked out in back that were rotting and rusting and whatever and had to be removed. A dealer in Seabrook offered to buy the old sludge truck for $7,500, and the former director was advised that if he put a little bit of money into it and rotated it and used that one day in the new sludge truck the next day, that we might get better use out of our investment, and apparently that was not done.
What about this Warren article?
I'm talking about vehicles, because I've been yelling about rolling stock all year, and I'm going to continue to holler about rolling stock, because we have a big problem here, and I'm not going to go voting for any more vehicle replacement until we have a complete assessment of everything that we own. It's over $5 million. You have as much invested in these vehicles, and I've said this to you face-to-face, you know that. I've said it face-to-face to the manager, right?
Okay, we're talking about this Warren
article.
We're
talking about this Warren article, and I'm not gonna, yes, I do.
Mr. Bean, would you have comments about this article?
I'm not done yet.
Well, we're moving on.
No, we're not moving on yet, because I want to talk
about
this.
We're talking about this
Warren article. I've asked all year to talk about rolling stock.
Right now, we're talking about this.
Until and unless we can get a complete assessment of everything in there.
We got your message.
Fine.
Mr. Bean.
I'm not gonna support it.
I have no comments, sir.
Please continue.
The next warrant articles are related to the Solid Waste Division. This first one is a warrant article for the Household Hazardous Waste Collection. This would look to invite the towns of Hampton Falls and Newcastle to participate. This would replace the hazardous waste event that was recently done by...
Epping.
Yes, holding it. It would include an awareness and education program. We would contract with a household hazardous waste contractor to run the collection day, and it would also include applying to NHDES for their household hazardous waste grant. This one is $20,000, and that's to hold the event.
You said you were going to apply for a grant for that?
Yes, you applied to DES for...
It's in the early part of the year that you apply.
You apply right in February or however it works out.
Any questions? Nope. Moving on.
Next one is a warrant article for construction and demolition waste dump carts and safety improvements. Right now, as you're all aware, the building debris is transported from people's vehicles over the Jersey barriers into the trailers below. These carts are intended to add safety and increase the potential injury that could happen if someone fell out of the back of their truck or wasn't paying attention to what they were doing. You'd load into these carts, and these carts would be lifted and dumped into the barrels versus direct dump from the cars. They also can be weighed. It's another form of looking at how we do our weighing, and our existing backhoe can run them. This is $20,000 for the carts, and it also would include some safety improvements to the railing system at the top of the transfer station.
Questions?
Does it, using these save any time or anything? Is there any labor savings in this as opposed to the way we're doing it now?
I don't want to guarantee that there would be a labor savings. I think that this is one of the ones I came up with. I see that there's a safety issue. When the trailers are empty, when they've been returned, I'm finding people standing still on top of the Jersey barriers trying to unload their trucks. Mm-hmm. If they slip and fall, it's a 13, 14-foot fall. I don't know how the fire department would respond to getting somebody out of there. I mean, we've already had people trip and fall in the compactor. It was bad enough. So I don't want anyone to fall into the trailers. The other thing is that we're finding is that people are, for instance, the call the other day was, put the propane tanks on the bottom, put all the lumber on top of it, then threw the propane tanks and the lumber into the container. We have to go and fish it out. What this would give us the capability to do is, yes, sir, there's where you can drop it. He goes and puts the load in, and you get to ensure whether, A, did they pay properly for what they're disposing, and what they're disposing, should it be going in that roll-off container. So it goes to the quantity and quality, safety of what we're disposing, but also safety of the workers, safety of the residents. I saw this as short money in comparison to have to pay out on a claim.
Okay, thank you.
Mr. Brown, questions? Mrs. Wolseley.
Where are these going to go?
They're basically
going
to be in the upper yard.
For the transfer station in the corner on the end?
Mm-hmm.
And you still have one section that has a cart that's still being used.
Yeah, if we have somebody, you know, with a big wagon, that, you know, a dump body wagon, a commercial contractor, mm-hmm. yeah, we'll still allow them to
so these are going to be placed below the damaged area now, or is it going to be in a separate area?
Up on top, right outside the transfer station.
So the damaged area will no longer be used?
The damaged area is going to have to get repaired.
Well, I guess so. And why it's in that condition is another question, but I'm not going to go on that at the moment. So these would be up top. They won't carry, they won't hold as much as the big roll-off.
Correct.
That used to be down there. So they'd have to be emptied at frequent intervals. What are they going to be emptied into?
Right into the roll-off truck.
They'll be carted down, around, and dumped.
They have a tilting action, so it'd be like you'd spill out into them. The carts are made to sort
but
of
what
lock.
I'm trying to say is that the cart that used to be below the damaged wall is no longer there.
No, it's still there.
It's still, you put it back? Because it wasn't there the last time I looked over. So this will keep people away from the damaged area, and it will go over and down?
Irregardless of the damaged area, it would keep people away from the people that have small loads.
Right.
You know, a couple of 2x4s, some leftover building materials.
Okay.
It would keep them from going right up to the rail and throwing their material off.
Right.
It also would check for loads. The material still has to be dropped into an open top trailer to be hauled to
wherever. The last time
wherever.
I looked, I think that one was missing. Okay.
Yeah. But, you know, it's irregardless of the status or condition of the wall. It really is to address a potential for a fall hazard.
Okay.
Mr. Bean.
No questions.
Continue, please.
Thank you.
The next one is for the replacement of one compactor. Up at the transfer station. The compactor that needs replacing is 21 years old. It has had plates welded to the floors to cover the holes that have formed, and we've also had to sort of rebuild it together to not have the sides collapse in. Basically, this is for $60,000. This includes, there's actually some trade-in value because of the metal of the compactor, but also includes the labor and replacement of the power unit for the compactor itself.
Questions?
And how bad is the one now?
It's holy. No.
Well, that can be a good thing.
Yeah. H-O-L-Y? Or?
Yeah. This is the compactor that's in the center. When that station was originally built, it had two. Then it went to three compactors. They just moved, traded one in, moved this one to the middle.
Yeah. Recycling.
Yeah, and so it has recycling. Now, you'd think recycling, God, cardboard and glass, what can be so bad about that? The glass actually is an abrasive, and it wears right through the floor.
Yeah.
So they've a number of times, we just call White's Welding. They come in and weld in a new plate. At the same time, the piston, that whole piston assembly either needs to come out and be rebuilt, or, I mean, they were just down there last week repairing a leak. If anyone ever gets to go down below, and I don't want you to, it's not a nice place to go, between the swill that comes out of the containers and the hydraulic fluid, it's one nasty place. So this is an effort to, this is a ticking time bomb as far as piece of equipment would go. If this were to break or break down in the middle of the summer when we're handling several hundred tons of recycling a week, we are out of business. And that'll be a tough situation for us.
Mr. Bridle.
Again, you're talking about something that's over 20 years old.
Exactly.
It's probably reached its useful life. It needs to be replaced.
Mrs. Wellesley. Oh. Mr. Bean.
Negative, sir.
If I may, for one, it may seem in some respect that this is overwhelming in comparison to, let's say, past years. Mr. Griffin has asked for a priority listing from us. When I came on in April, Fred asked me, tell me all the things that you need within this department, so this is a result of that CIP generation and of us identifying operational issues. I'll understand if not all the operational issues get resolved the first swing through, but it would have been remiss for Jennifer and I not to be forthcoming to you and the residents to let you know what we face for issues and what needs to be repaired. Thank you.
What we have here is a warrant article for 200 cubic yard injection refuse trailers and a yard horse. These trailers that we're talking about are what the trash is put into and the recyclables. They do have the injection part so that it can be emptied. And when those go, the guys can tell you that is not fun to have to clean out and put all back in. It wasn't someone's favorite project. But the idea here is just capacity. With the trailers that we have, this would not be to replace. This is to add to provide more capacity for the materials. Right now, we don't have any backup capacity. So again, if it were to be an extraordinary or something else were to go down, such as one of these injection trailers not working, which we did encounter once or twice over the last
Labor Day
months.
Weekend, yeah. Being the big weekend it was, one of the issues that we had is that the power unit, the piston, the pusher, in the recycling trailer went. It would not push the refuse out. The company that works on them in Kittery wouldn't accept the trailer with the waste in it because then there's no way for them to replace it. So we literally went over in the corner of the yard next to the sand pile and, using the backhoe, pulled out all the recycling material.
Which only imagined
on the
you
ground.
Didn't have to put it all back in.
It had to go back in at some point. Having that trailer down, in a combination of having the other three of them were actually full, we were down to, if we'd had to operate another half day, we would have had no place to put the refuse. We were that maxed out. So it became very apparent that we don't have any backup. We don't have any additional capacity. So we had a great summer as weather-wise and the number of people that went to the beach. As a result, we had
a really good amount of refuse, and on those particular weekends, we are really maxed out.
Questions? Mr. Wardell?
No.
Mr. Bridle?
Only comment I have is on your yard horse. Again, it's 1980, but I think the more important thing is it doesn't have the hydraulics on it.
Right.
And I know when they had the fire in there this summer.
It's the main reason, yep.
They had to cut the hole in the roof of it,
yes.
First of all, because they couldn't push the stuff out. And so there's no way to get that stuff out if you do have a problem. And I've been to a number of Packer fires over the years to know that it doesn't happen all the time, mm-hmm. but it is going to happen every time, eventually.
Right. Someone took and I think they had the last burn with a pellet stove and took the pellets and put them in the... They apparently thought they were out, and they put them in with the rest of the trash, and the pellets got mixed in with chair, ottoman, something else, something nicely flammable. And even I was impressed how quickly it got going and it warped the outside wall, the heat alone. And the issue was that we had to wait another 45 minutes for Triano to come back with a tractor that had the hydraulic capability to push to make the push bar work. The trailers that we're asking for have no power capability of themselves. They run right off the tractor. So it's that hydraulic pump or capacity that actually pushes the refuse out.
Mrs. Wolseley?
I have a problem with this. When we bought the ejection trailers, we bought six of them, to the best of my recollection, about $55,000 apiece.
Yep.
I don't like the idea of us owning these. I think this is an area where we should be leasing or having the carrier provide the trailer. This would put us up to eight. And the yard horse is nothing more than an old vehicle that's no longer roadworthy, that you have to put the fifth wheel on and the other. Can we not take one of our old vehicles and adapt it instead of going, you know, why do we want to buy a vehicle to be a yard horse?
The yard horse is what we use to pull the trailers in and out. If we were to use a regular tractor trailer,
yeah.
The wheelbase, the turning radius wouldn't allow us to move around the yard. So the yard horse is just that. It's a short haul.
Right.
Pull trailers in and out.
Right.
We're not going to buy a brand new one.
We can't adapt a piece of equipment that we have now to serve as
don't
that.
Have any. The only thing I could think to make it happen is take the Mac.
Okay.
Pull the bucket off that,
yeah.
Put it and weld on a hitch.
A fifth wheel, yeah.
And everything else together.
It just seems for something like a yard horse, which is only literally horsing those trailers around, it seems.
You don't have the hydraulic capabilities then, do you?
No, not on the Mac.
Again, I'm looking to see your priority list.
Yes.
Please continue.
And we have the warrant article for our building. Basically, our building was built in 67 with the garage and office sections added. The pictures that you're seeing here is typical of most of the doors. I did have someone come out and actually look at them. They are repairable. They are not structural damage. But the longer and longer these issues go, the greater the problems are going to become with the rot and the rust. A lot of cold air gets in. The bottom picture shows you the painting job that was done, but you can see at the corners the rust is forming. That was just the one side that I think got done a year or so ago. It's very, very labor intensive because you have to scrub it all down, get all the metal clean before you can put on the special paint. So what this warrant article is asking for is $85,000 to work on these jams. And this would have no tax implication this year. It would be from the undesignated general fund balance.
Mr. Waddell?
No.
Mr. Bridle?
All set.
Mrs. Wolseley?
I'm not willing to tap the undesignated fund balance for any of this. Number two, Public Works has carried an over $5 million budget, and this to me looks like normal maintenance. And Chris just took over. I'm not trying to dump on you.
I understand.
But this is normal maintenance. And it's pretty bad to see a building neglected like this, things that should have been done out of the normal operating budget. That's
Mr.
it.
Mr. Bean, continue, please.
And that is it?
Okay, for myself, again, I would like to see your priority list.
Can we just, you know, Chris and Jennifer, thank you for bringing this in, and it is overwhelming, and I agree. And I think you've done a really great job on identifying this, and it's a real shame that over the years, we haven't kept up with all this stuff. And it comes to the point where you come to a meeting, and you have to be talking about stuff that we should have been planning for and going along the maintenance all along, keeping things in good shape. So, yeah, a priority list would be great. And, you know, I'm with you on helping you on trying to get it, but it is overwhelming, and we'll see what we can do. And thank you for putting it together and identifying everything.
Mr. Rydell?
No, I think you guys are doing a good job. I agree. It is overwhelming, but this isn't something that you've had much of a hand in, because both of you are fairly new to that department. We'll have to take a look at it and see what it is.
Yep.
As far as your vehicles, I'm sure all your vehicles have been analyzed. I know you went through your list. That's what you have the people doing it for. That's what you're there to do.
Right.
You're the ones that are supposed to analyze it. You're the ones that are supposed to come to us and let us know that. And I appreciate that. Thank you.
Good.
Mrs. Wolseley.
I appreciate you putting all of this together, because it's certainly an impressive list. I want to say about Director Jacobs that you inherited 30 years worth. 30 years worth of mismanagement in that department. And it's a wonder you didn't run out the door hollering. So I understand that, and I appreciate that. And you have given us a great overview. And I'm still waiting for the washdown septic. When's that coming?
Mr. Bean.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Yes.
Did you want to respond to that?
No.
No.
Mr.
Thank you.
Well,
yeah, it's got to be prioritized. That's about a $6 million price tag that you guys have ginned up. That would be a 24% increase in taxes alone. Just for public works. We've got guys looking for pay raises, hadn't had pay raises in a long time. I see the director smiling. And, infrastructure in this town, in this state, across the country is neglected. And it's going to require a come to Jesus moment, if you will. And we're going to have that moment pretty soon. And Selectman Woolsey is adamant, and it's her opinion, it's rightfully so. We have $23 million in the bank. We have literally a bicentennial park that looks like a ghetto. It's an embarrassment. We have troops, if you will, driving trucks that could cost them their life. It's a ridiculous standard. And I think in light of your infrastructure and operational upgrades that you talked to today, you really need to look at that $19 million and see what that buys us to get us on the level playing field right now. And when that comes up, I think the board, in lieu of what you want, in lieu of what fire wants, and these are not extravagant demands. You're not asking for a brand new coffee spot, a new kitchen. These are base level. And I would say that it's a very tough job, and I'll wrap up real quick. I know there's people here to speak on other issues. But Public Works is our biggest department. You guys have done a great job, and I think it's been very well managed, with a few exceptions, and you can't get it right all the time in the last 30 years. And I know Rusty and I work there, and you guys do a hell of a job. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you thank for coming you. In. You've started a good conversation. And
I hope so.
Please get that
priority list.
Sooner the better, so that we can all be thinking about it.
All right. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, Jen, for
next,
all the...
Yep. We have John Nyan, Fran McMahon, Jason, the town planner here.
And Mr. Griffin, too.
We are all the appointed representatives to the Hampton Beach Area Commission. Mr. McMahon is representing the planning board. So one of the reasons why I invited John here, I'm sorry you guys had to wait so long. There's lots of important stuff going on. Is so that we could be caught up with what's happening there as far as the Hampton Area Commission's transportation study and traffic study, which we have a $375,000 federal grant. Would you like to say something?
Sure.
He's not bashful.
Congratulations for all that you did down there at the, with the new sidewalk. It looks beautiful.
Thank you. When Chairman Griffin asked if I would come in with Fran and Jason, we like the opportunity to be able to talk to as many groups about the transportation grant as possible. So I was more than welcome to accept his invitation to come in. Very, very briefly, this is a grant that's run by the Hampton Beach Area Commission, managed by the New Hampshire Department of Transportation with a contractor in place called VHB. We've asked them to come in and help us revisit the Hampton Beach Master Plan around the transportation components of the plan. We did receive a federal grant through Federal Highway to do this, and we started last spring actually putting together some priorities, identifying a project plan, worked with the Department of Transportation, and then also participated in their selection of VHB. VHB then came in and started to really redefine the areas of the master plan that had transportation written on it, and we then started the a public hearing process where we wanted to get input from the general public, public officials with regard to transportation issues at Hampton Beach and how they actually apply to the master plan. We had one public hearing in June. We had a number of social media strategies throughout the summer where we received a fair amount of input from general public, tourist, residents. We had a second public hearing in October. Both, by the way, public hearings were televised on Channel 22. So thank you to Channel 22 to carry those. And we continue. We'll be continuing over the next couple of months collecting input information from a variety of different organizations. On December 2nd, we will be meeting with the town, public safety, police, fire, public works, to kind of get their input on some of the ideas and options that have been put out so far. And a lot of the work that's being done now, I might emphasize, is futuristic. This is not something that we're talking about where once we get it adapted into the master plan that we will go to work and do these improvements next year. We're talking about what we're saying and what we're planning today will have an impact, if any, in 2019-2020. But this is the way we have to follow the master plan, and this is the way we have to follow how we go step by step with regard to revisiting the master plan and going from there. So when Chairman called and said that Fran and Jason were going to be here, my feeling is that we're open for any types of questions that you might have. I'm not here to make a prepared presentation.
Well, we appreciate that you've come in tonight. And, you know, one reason why I suggested this is because I'd like to let people know that it's not too late for them to give us some input, particularly the people that live in these areas. I know that we've really tried hard to get a lot of input, and we have been successful getting a lot of input, particularly from Facebook. But to me, I'm surprised that there's really not more people that are in these particular areas that are going to be affected responding, and I hope that more people come forward. And I just wanted to say a little bit about this. This is a plan that should be comprehensive and is probably going to be, like John just said, implemented in stages. It needs to be fair to everybody that's in this area. You know, on Ocean Boulevard, and it primarily concerns Ocean Boulevard and Ashworth Avenue. And I think that as far as the town of Hampton is concerned, Ashworth Avenue is very important. Money spent here on Ashworth Avenue that might be coming as part of this plan is money that's going to be spent that we may not have to ask the taxpayers for in the future. The state has a responsibility on Ocean Boulevard, as we all know. Hampton has already spent $12 million on the infrastructure, the sidewalks, the sewer, the drainage, $8 million for a police station, $4 million for a fire station. The precinct has got their new parking facility there on Ashworth Avenue. The town also has their town parking that is this year going to bring in more than over $600,000, probably closer to $650,000. So this is important for the town. This area has a lot of future potential that's probably going to be fairly immediate, particularly in like the areas of the casino, the areas where, you know, there are some motels that are actually not even open at this point. And, you know, to me, you know, it's very important what's going to be done here. For one thing, for many years, the side streets haven't been, ever since I've been here for the last 40 years, even then, there were businesses that were on the side streets. They gradually burnt down and weren't replaced, and they were left with just parking lots or very real little business or development that could help the Hampton tax base. But I think all of these areas, there's room to have a lot of future taxable buildings built on these lots. And as you hear, we certainly are looking for more tax money coming in because we have plenty of ways to spend it. Also, from the study, we've also found out that the parking lots that are there that are private are very important. And a lot of people feel that they're, right now, according to the study, they've said that we have about 1,000 extra parking spaces a day that aren't being used. So we still have plenty of parking, but in the future, when these spaces are, if they were used in a different way, you know, there's going to be more problems then. So I think it's really important that we take a look at everything. Another thing is about the new height restrictions voted on, I believe it was last year, for 80 feet. There's an area that pretty much goes from Ashworth Avenue to the end of the casino parking lot on both sides of the street. And I know that the reason why, am I right, Mr. McMahon, that was done because you feel that that's a potential area for future development.
Yeah, very much so. And it's actually 70 feet in there.
It's 70 feet. Yeah.
But yes, we felt that that was a real hot area for potential substantial development. And it goes from Ashworth, Ocean Boulevard, northerly intersection of Ashworth, Ocean, to F Street, and includes both sides of Ashworth.
Mm-hmm. So this is certainly, you know, an important area. One of the things that I'm concerned about is with all the development of new condos that are down there, I think that that we do need to take another look of what really should be done about Ashworth Avenue being possibly two ways with the third lane in the middle for left-hand turns. I know that the road was developed with the idea that it could be done this way. We were planning on doing it this way at the beginning. I think that if it was two ways, I think that it might be a lot better for the future of, like, the new condominium that's going in there. If I was buying there, I certainly wouldn't want to have to, every time I went to my home, have to go up Ashworth Avenue, go around, get stuck in that traffic. And I think we really have to take a look at the recommendations that are being offered here. One of the things that happened, and I know that Mr. Leedy said that when the work was done about 12 years ago, that he was concerned about there, in some of the sidewalks, there are things from signs to telephone poles, this and that, and he saw this as something that really needs to be changed. I really can't explain why it was done to begin with, except for that they did it that way so that there would be enough room to have a three-lane road there. And so I'm confident that there is the ability to do this. The police and the firefighters, which I realize John's going to be meeting with, I'm hoping that we can make sure that they are available to work with Mr. Leedy so that if there is possibilities of something happening, they can do it, rather than just having the fire chief or the police chief come and say, when there is a final plan, that this is something that's not going to work. I think if they all work together, it might be a better possibility of finding a good solution. I think also that this was done 12 years ago, and we are now looking for a solution to the traffic problem. So I think the way we've done it so far, like it's been done for the last 12 years, probably isn't the best answer, which is doing it just the way it's being done today, because we're still looking for a better answer. So I think there are other possibilities. Mr. Waddell.
Thanks for coming in, guys. I went to the presentation. I think you guys are doing a great job. I think you're including everybody, including all the departments. You're really doing a good job of that, and I'm sure that you're going to measure twice and cut once.
I've seen a number of the proposals or suggestions they've had. I like some of the parking ideas, especially up north of the Ashworth, where they've moved some stuff around and stuff like that. I'm not a big proponent of two-way on Ashworth Ave. I think that makes it tough. I think that's it's a narrow area to begin with, and when you start to have turning vehicles, I think it's already traffic. I think if we fix the bridge, that will help a lot of that down there. That'll alleviate a lot of that problem. But I think if you start to make that two-way on there, that would be a real issue. But you've done a good job so far. As he said, I'm sure you'll measure twice and cut once. So thank you for doing it.
Mrs. Wellesley.
The bridge. And the one thing, and I'm sorry to correct the chairman, but the town spent $17.5 million on that infrastructure. It was $5.5 million in interest on that. And the water company spent another million down there redoing. That was an expensive project. Thank you for your hard work. Don't forget that bridge.
Thanks, gentlemen.
So, if I may, Mr. Chairman, and I know we're on live, so I'll keep it brief. One of the things, and you brought it up, which I think is very important, not only for the six of you, but for the people that are listening at home, there are some serious options being thrown out of the study so far. Probably the hottest topic is Ashworth Ave, and whether or not it stays one way or two way. And that's an issue that, and one of the reasons why I reached out to the town manager to say, I need to bring in public safety into this discussion. Because before we even go to the business owners on Ashworth Avenue, I want to make sure that we can feasibly do it from a safety perspective. If we then get a good feeling from police, fire, and public works, then I'm going to reach out to the business owners on both sides of Ashworth Ave. But I don't want to go to that point until I get a really comfortable feeling from the town on whether or not it's even feasible to go two ways. So I appreciate your time.
So where is this meeting going to be with the police and the fire?
I am hoping that we can have it here in this boardroom. I have to check the availability, but it will be, the town manager has assured me that the three different departments will be here. We've already confirmed with DOT and Gordon Liddy that they're coming down to have that discussion with them. So
is this going to be televised? I think it's important that it is, because, you know, there's a lot of different ways you can look at this. I was on 128, and it was bumper to bumper and backed up completely. All four lanes across were full, and the police and the firefighters were coming along. People still get out of the way. Mm-hmm. I think that there's many chances when people might want to get to the police station or to the fire station, and they might have an easier time doing it if the road was two ways. Mm-hmm. And I think this is important, and I think that it should be something that's done in public. Okay. So I would hope that it would
be. Let me talk to Fred about that.
Mr. Welch, what?
Yeah.
As long as we have the people who are can be here to do it, mm-hmm. televised.
Yeah.
Okay.
So have you got all of this set up already for on the 2nd?
Yes.
Yeah.
It's just a matter of finding the location. And as I said, I was hoping to use this room.
Mm-hmm. And maybe we can have it taped so that it can be seen.
Talk to Christina in the morning, and we'll see if we can square that up at the same time, square up the cable TV.
Very good.
Okay. And Jason, do you have something that you could add about any of this?
No, I think that John did a nice job describing the project, and I've been happy to assist with it and be involved with it in HBAC as well. And
we appreciate it.
I think it's a good thing.
And Fran?
No, I look at the project as a potential of a once-in-a-lifetime decision, so it's very important for everybody, the community at large, and all the boards and the administration to be very actively involved. So,
and we have a meeting coming up this Thursday night. It's going to be at the police station.
Mm-hmm.
And so if people did want to come and comment, they could come and comment at the beginning of the meeting?
That's correct. We have an open mic at the beginning
mm-hmm.
of each of our meetings, so yes. And we will be having another public hearing on this matter.
When do you think that will be?
Probably right after the holidays.
Okay, great. Thank you very much for coming in, and thank you for waiting.
Thank you.
We appreciate it. And we have Dick DeRocher, the Energy Commission, Sarah Hill, Solar City. Thank you for coming in. I'm sorry that you had to wait so long.
Thank you for having us. You caught me all the way up here.
Yeah, you can sit.
Just to keep you company.
You can join us up at the table too, if you'd like.
Arena,
come on, Arena.
Thank you for coming in, and thank you all for being patient.
You got it. Upper right.
Mr. Bean's always there with a chair for a pretty girl.
Seems like I always get tail end Charlie at these things. I don't know what it is.
Well, they usually, I will tell you what it is. They always go with the town employees first.
Yeah, that's okay. That's okay. I'm Dick DeRocher, Chairman of the Energy Committee. I'd like to introduce Irina Colenti, one of our committee members. Julie Martinelli, committee member, and Sarah Hill from Solar City. We issued a request for proposal to six solar contractors and solar developers to give us proposals to develop a solar system on a landfill using a power purchase agreement concept and a net metering concept. We ask that the design be sufficient to provide all the electric service needed by the town's municipal accounts. Out of the six proposals or requests that we sent out, we received proposals from two companies, New Hampshire Solar Garden and Solar City. New Hampshire Solar Garden is based in Stratham. They've been in business for about 4 years.
They use as a financier Golden Goose Capital. We did some vetting on Golden Goose Capital, and it was a little bit on the shaky side. Their primary interest is in property management of the dormitories and the buildings at UNH, although we did find that their president and Andrew Keller, the head of New Hampshire Solar Garden, they're on each other's boards. So they kind of work together. They have sufficient insurance to do the construction and to make sure there's no damage. They will be responsible for completing the fencing around the landfill site. They will also maintain the property around the arrays that will be developed. I asked the New Hampshire Solar Garden for two references, both dealing with landfill and landfill constructions. Milton, New Hampshire at Hillsborough. It turns out that both of these towns picked New Hampshire Solar Garden as a sole source. They did not use an RFP or competitive process. They were marketed by Andrew Keller. Andrew's a good guy. He's very sharp. He's technically very competent. He knows what he's doing. And he convinced both towns just to go with them as a sole source.
There's only three, Rick.
Nice. Solar City is based in San Mateo, California, been in business for 9 years. They are a public company. They offer a 20-year warranty on panels and inverters. I could not get that same information from Solar Garden, in that until they get a contract, they don't determine who their vendors are going to be, and therefore they don't give out a lot of information on the equipment that they're going to use. Solar City recently purchased a panel manufacturing company, so they're going to be in business for a long time. They're going to be around for quite some time. Solar City will allow us, the town, to purchase the solar system at year 6 and year 10, and obviously at the end of the term of 20 years. Solar Garden wouldn't offer that, they wouldn't offer that benefit. And the chairman of Solar City is Elon Musk, and I think he's fairly popular, fairly famous. I'll let Sarah go in and talk to her company. Oh, references. I forgot the references.
That's okay.
I'll get them.
Okay. Oh, somehow I went back to the beginning. Okay.
I got two references from Solar City, both with landfill constructions, both in Massachusetts, or one in Massachusetts and one in Connecticut. Needham, Mass., that system is under construction. Mr. Hank Half, him and I were on the phone for about an hour and a half. Hank was very, very generous and very, very pleased with his business with Solar City, and he highly recommended Solar City. The second reference was the Connecticut Municipal Electric Energy Commission. You could read the words there, but they're very, very glowing, very flowery. They were very much in favor of Solar City and very happy with the relationship they have with them.
Hi, I'm Sarah Hill, and also a Hampton resident as well as a Solar City employee. So I was very excited to see the RFP come out for solar in my town. I won't go repeat too much of what Dick said, but we have been in business for 9 years. We have recently opened a location in Manchester, New Hampshire, April of this year. So we have 40 locations throughout the nation, but now have over 100 New Hampshire employees, and have about 2 megawatts of systems going up in New Hampshire currently. So that's also very exciting because solar's fairly new to the state. So nationwide, we have about 15,000 employees at this point, growing fast because I see here this still says 12, but that was only a couple months ago. Talking to financing again, we have $8 billion set aside with our financing partners for these solar projects. So you won't go through the project and have any trouble getting financing when you get to the stage of building. We own, operate, maintain, design, build the solar system, or our solar systems. So when you sign an agreement or a contract with us, you don't have to have employees hired to take care of the system. We do that. We monitor it. There's web-based monitoring so that you can monitor it as well and see how much power is being produced by the solar system. As Dick said, we do offer the sale of the system if the town chooses to purchase it at those increments. If the town does not choose to purchase the solar system, at the end of the contract, we are obligated to just take it down. So it is not a worry 20 years from now, well, what's going to happen with this when we're either not in office or, you know, don't want to buy it or what have you. So the default of the contract or the agreement would be that we just take it down. Here's some of our financing partners. So all of our financing, again, is done in-house, so it is reliable and not something in question. Here are some of our partners that we've worked with. We partner with, I personally work in the municipal sector, so we partner with about 1,300 commercial and municipal customers and partners right now. So here's just a few of them that we can do landfill arrays, or we can cover buildings or what have you. And landfill arrays are really up and coming, great idea, because it's otherwise unused land. It makes money for the town and it is producing clean energy. Here's just a note about our New Hampshire employees and the governor and our ribbon cutting this spring. So we can go in a little bit about the system, or
The system we're planning to build, would like to build, is a 2.4 megawatt system. It will be built in two separate arrays. One array will be outputted directly into the primary side of the wastewater treatment plant meter. It will supply power directly to the wastewater treatment plant. The second array will be outputted into the meter at the transfer station. That particular meter and that array will be used in a group net metering concept where the transfer station, or whatever we want to call it, would be a host and would allocate the output to the various stations or the various meters throughout the system. The reason for going in this behind the meter concept is to avoid the massive distribution and delivery charges by Unitil or any particular utility that we want to use. The arrays will take up about 7,700 panels. We'll be using a poured ballast system, and we'll have a picture of that for you so that you can see that. Our system meets all the requirements of PUC 900, as well as RSA 362A, which deals with renewables and which deals with net metering and the concepts and rules and regulations of net metering. We're targeting an operation in November of 2016. You want to describe that picture?
Sure. So, yeah, this is just a layout that we put together of the system on top of the landfill. So, as you can see, it would the panels would sort of blanket the flat upper portion of the landfill, not be installed on the slopes. And the green lines there are the transmission lines to the wastewater treatment facility, as well as the transfer station. So it's essentially two parcels, because since it's a 2 megawatt system, your maximum capacity under Unitil or the PUC is a 1 megawatt system, so we have to have it as two separate parcels. So that's sort of just an aerial shot of what it would look like. Again, with how it's installed, is it is a ballasted system, so you wouldn't be penetrating the cap of the landfill. It's poured concrete, self-leveling technology, so as if there's any slight shifting of the landfill, the system kind of levels itself out, so there's not a worry that the panels would shift all over the place. Low-pressure ground equipment when we do installation so as not to disturb the cap as well. Distributed string inverter design has it so there are multiple smaller inverters on each string of panels instead of one large heavy inverter located somewhere on the landfill, so that also helps distribute the load on the cap of the landfill and allows for more flexibility of how it can be installed with the panels. And here's just a picture of what the racking would look like on the top of the landfill.
We figured the load on the landfill on the cap would be about 50 pounds total load, which would be the racking system and the panels would be about 50 pounds per square foot. I think I exceed that, so I can't go up there. But we should have Phil, not a problem.
So the basic thing that we're offering here is a power purchase agreement. So essentially, it's another utility bill for solar, but the solar cost is much lower than the Unitil cost. So you're saving. You're not paying for the solar. We pay for the solar. And so there's no upfront capital investment. In fact, there's savings in year one. So all of the things we were talking about for the DPW earlier, this might help a little bit. But there's also a performance guarantee that we offer, so we'll tell you how much the system is expected to produce, so you can sort of get an idea of how to budget. And if it doesn't produce that much, we pay you back. So it's a true up over 5 years, but we look at weather in New Hampshire, and we know how much the system is supposed to produce for you. So again, there's savings on day one, and we own the system, so anytime you need to point a finger, it's us, and I live here, so it makes it a little easier.
I'll go through that.
Okay.
When we looked at the financial projections, what we're trying to do, or what we're what we were doing, was comparing the cost differential between having a solar system and not having a solar system. And we tried to project that over 20 years, which would be the term of the contract. Okay. You know, and I'm sure you're well aware, that we currently have a fixed price contract with Constellation, which takes us out to November of 2016. We're paying 7.45 cents a kilowatt hour. And the model that we put together, I assumed that we were going to stay with that rate for the first year under solar. When we look at the non-solar system, whether we're buying from Unitil or whether we're buying from Constellation or whatever, we would be paying that 7.45 cents. But we're also paying a variety of distribution fees, delivery charges, demand charges, etc. So what we're effectively paying Unitil would be the kilowatt hour charge plus the fees, which would be in the neighborhood of a total of 13.5 or 14 cents a kilowatt hour. That's what we're effectively paying right now. One of the major factors when you're trying to look out over 20 years is how rapidly or how much the utility price is escalating every year, okay? Which makes a big difference in your projections. Okay. Unitil has estimated about a 3.8% escalation rate every year. We went back and took a look through the EIA Energy Institute of America and their history, and from 2001 to 2014, they're showing an escalation rate of about an average of about 2.3%. But from 2006 to 2014, the escalation rate was 0.6%. So in the model that we put together, we have used an escalation rate of 1%. So we're being very, very conservative in the assumptions that we're making. New Hampshire Solar Garden, when I put these assumptions into their model, their savings were negative. There were no savings whatsoever. That's primarily because they used the Unitil escalation rate of 3.8, and they escalated their PPA, or their price that we're going to pay them for solar, at 2.25%. That put them into the negative. With SolarCity, we're looking at a 20-year term. The output for the first year is about 2,800,000 kilowatt hours. They have offered a fixed PPA rate, or fixed utility rate, basically, for the full 20 years of 10 cents. Our year one projected savings, again, this is fairly conservative, is about $34,000. And over the course of 20 years, we should be saving about $1.8 million. Don't hold me to the numbers. I don't plan to be around in 20 years. So, you know, plus SolarCity will pay us a $6,000 a year pilot, which is nothing more than a property tax, okay, for the use of the property. Go ahead. Again, the financial projections are very conservative. One of the things that we have not been able to pin down completely is the fees and the rates that Unitil will charge us for using their infrastructure. The reason is they really have no experience with a system of this nature, using net metering, going behind the meter, using the infrastructure for some of it, but not all of it. So what we've done in our projections, in our model, is put in every fee that we could imagine into the various pricing categories. So we're really, really conservative with it. The next issue we have is net metering. Unitil currently has about 3.4 or 3.6 megawatts remaining in their net meter quota, which has been provided by the legislature. We're looking for 2.4 megawatts of that. Our hope and our desire is to get our application in as soon as possible. However, there is a lot of work going on in Concord to either eliminate the net metering quota or at least increase it, which would be a very beneficial thing for us.
Dick, can I just interrupt? Can you just, because people listening might not understand what net metering is.
Yep.
Could you just explain what net metering is, please? You know, for people
I don't understand it either.
I can explain it. So it's basically when you're putting the solar onto the grid, net metering is when it's calculated out over the course of a year. So you're putting 28 million kilowatt hours onto the grid, or 28 million kilowatt hours onto the grid. 2 million kilowatt hours. Thank you. But you're not necessarily using that much. It'll be spread other places that maybe Unitil, we're just sharing their infrastructure. So you'll get credit for when you're producing solar but not using it. And when you're not producing solar but need power, you'll still get Unitil's power. So it kind of nets out. So that's what
But if net metering's all used up, then you don't?
So the cap for the state is 50 megawatts. Unitil was given 6. They've had some installed. If any other towns or cities put projects in before we do, there's no space left. And that's just a hypothetical. That's just what they put in place. So that's why they're trying to lift that. It can be lifted, hopefully, for more solar projects to be put in place.
Okay.
Yeah, there's a lot of work going on in Concord right now, from both sides of the aisle, to eliminate the quota. I mean, the state has been given a time frame by which they have to have somewhat like 27-28% of the power generated by renewable sources. So they've got to start moving in that direction.
as has the neighboring states. Massachusetts, for example, is very, very friendly toward renewables. And I think there's a strong drive to bring New Hampshire into that body. The other issue that we're looking at very closely is the solar incentive tax credit. It's a 30% tax credit. It's really, I think, the primary incentive for a company like Solar City to offer a power purchase agreement. That tax credit expires on the end of December in 2016. So a system, in order to qualify for the tax credit, has to be operational and generating energy. So again, you know, that tax credit has been extended in the past, and we're kind of hoping it gets extended again. So
the municipality doesn't get the tax credit. The owner of the system,
right, they get it.
That's their money.
That helps pay for,
we're able to pass those savings through in that power purchase agreement, right, cost that we offered.
One more.
Mm-hmm.
So what we're looking for, again, we're not asking for money. We want to generate some revenue. We're asking that the select board provide an approval to lease a portion of the landfill to Solar City to put up a solar system. I know that you can only authorize up to 5 years as a board, but we're asking you to do that. We will be submitting a warrant article which will ask the voters to approve a 20-year lease purchase. And I think that warrant article has either been drafted or is in process, right? He's looking at me like I don't know anything about it. And finally, we are asking that the town manager be authorized to negotiate and sign a PPA contract with Solar City, which will allow Solar City and the town to move forward to make application for net metering quota and also possibly start into the permitting process. However, you know, no real work will be done, no site surveys will be done until approval from the voters is obtained in March. Questions?
Mr. Welch, would you like to comment?
Interesting proposal. Most of them are. I'm sure the wheeling charges are going to be interesting depending on what units all these sides they're going to put into the mix. And I've got some questions. How does this affect our 80% ratchet on demand?
How does it affect what?
The 80% ratchet on demand.
What's that?
Their utility rates have an 80% ratchet clause on demand. If we use 10,000 kilowatt hours on the average and demand ratio, and all of a sudden we drop it to nothing, we're going to pay for 10,000 kilowatt hours of electricity, yeah, whether we use it or not.
I don't think we know the answer to that yet.
It's a very important answer.
Absolutely.
Because we could double or triple our bill.
Absolutely. We're definitely looking at that, and we will have hopefully some answers before we have to sign a contract.
Okay.
You're
going to have an answer before you sign the contract, because it's a pretty important part.
Absolutely. Two of our members, well, one works for Unitil, and the other has retired from Unitil recently, and they're both working with the Unitil billing managers to resolve all the issues with Unitil as to what we're going to pay.
Assuming they're going to have a rate that they're going to put together.
Well, that's what we figured, but we don't know. Yeah, we'll know what it is shortly.
Well, without knowing what that rate is, there's no way I think the town could commit to that.
Correct.
Because of the obvious financial burdens on the other side, depending on what they decide.
Mm-hmm.
And I don't know how the wheeling charges fit into that, but it would have to be expressed somehow in the rate.
Correct.
In order to figure it out. But this is the first time you've told me that this is a lease purchase instead of a lease. And there's a big difference.
I thought we had discussed that the other day.
Not the purchase. Because lease purchase obligates us to purchase on the other end.
Uh-oh.
There is no other obligation. We are obligated to purchase on the other end,
mm-hmm,
whether it be for a dollar or whatever.
Mm-hmm.
We're obligated to purchase it. So that's a big difference in how the warrant article is put together. And I suspect that you would give a recommendation after looking at those costs and expenses to the board from the committee, because the board's going to be looking for that recommendation. And certainly, we're going to be looking at it from a financial standpoint as to whether or not we can afford that 20 years out the end. I am suggesting to you that if we're going to do this, depending on what those financials look out to be, probably owning it in the other end is probably a good deal.
Mm-hmm.
That depends upon the obsolescence of the equipment and other things that
right.
come into play.
Yeah.
I've been, along with town council, reviewing the PPA contract that you sent over. It's going to need a lot of work.
Mm-hmm.
There are some things in there that just we could not sign, period. There's just no way about that. So we need to start working on that and see if we can come down with a contract that sort of everybody can agree to and we can live with. And I think that's probably the biggest catch in this whole thing is that one contract and what we have to live with for 20 years. So.
Yeah, I think Sarah needs to get her folks together with Mark and yourself. And
yeah, it's quite involved, as you know.
Right.
None of these things are easy.
Right.
Fortunately, it's only electric power, so it's not that bad. Of course, then you can have you get a little shock out of it, but hopefully the shock will be one that's a pleasant one and not too high a voltage or not too much amperage. I am concerned about how you connect up to the utilities at the transfer station and at the wastewater treatment facility, and how that power is transmitted in what fashion and how those wires are laid. And I'm assuming they're going to be in conduit, they're going to be grounded and encased and so forth.
Correct. They will be.
Yeah. And I'm also concerned about what DES is going to have to say about putting the material in the landfill.
Yeah, that's part of the permitting process right. that we're trying to get to. So.
Right, and that's very important. As right. you, I have to tell you, yeah,
there's an awful lot of wickets that A lot of work that we have to do to get from here to there, but we wanted to give you a status report, where we are, what it looks like, what we're looking at.
Well, we need to get to work earnestly and try to get those things answered so right. that we can come back to the board so they can consider giving you approval.
Right.
I know they can only give you 5 years. That's mm-hmm. the end of the ball game, so to speak. I'm a little concerned that that's the only thing they can give you. At the end of the 5 years, they can renew it, obviously.
Mm-hmm.
But if the town meeting should vote no,
then we're dead anyway. Yeah.
You're dead right there on the spot.
Right.
So
exactly.
Even the 5 years doesn't make any difference.
Right.
So I am concerned about that. So we need to have answers to a lot of different questions that's mm-hmm. going on right now. I know you know that. So I'm going to recommend to the board that we get those answers, get them back to the board, so that we all know what we're dealing with, and you folks know what you're dealing mm-hmm. with as well. I know we're going to need some recommendations, specific recommendations from you as to what we should be doing.
Got it.
Yeah. Mr. Bridle.
No, I think at face value, it's a great concept.
Okay.
Devil's in the details, though. Mm-hmm. And that's the big point. I, like Fred had said, is concerned about what DES is going to say about on the landfill
mm-hmm.
and what's our liability if something does go array up there. I'm going to wait back and see what we hear from the town manager and the council. Thanks.
Mrs. Wolseley.
Yeah, after what Fred has said, I'm not going to waste time on comments. I did go through the entire packet that you gave us, and I appreciate it, but there's no sense in asking any more questions at the moment until you sort out.
We need answers to the questions, so you know you have them. You need them in order to vote on.
Right.
Mr. Bean.
Yeah, great work, committee members. Really exciting stuff, and you're moving the chains, and working with Fred and Public Works Director, it looks like it may have some really good potential, and it's really great work, and thank you very much.
Mr. Wardell.
Yeah, good work and really exciting, but a couple of things that I think about right off the top of my head is a 20-year lease
mm-hmm.
with a quickly changing technology.
Mm-hmm.
You know, what happens if in 2-3 years the technology changes so dramatically that this becomes obsolete, which could very easily do? Does the company, and you don't have to tell us now, does the company then come in and replace anything or put anything new in there? The other thing is the net metering. I think that has to be answered. Mm-hmm. And the assumptions of how much you're going to produce. If you don't produce as much as you say and you end up buying from the mm-hmm. electric company, the power that's not being produced, you know, what's that going to cause? I think there are questions there. And the other thing is on the pilot, like the $6,000 a year.
Yeah.
Would this be something, I mean, with utilities, we assess the utilities and put a property tax on them.
Would this different, be? Different situation. Different this situation. Is governed by a different portion of the statute.
Right. Okay. All right. So, I mean, those types of questions, and, yeah. and I'm sure you guys are going to try to come up with those.
I can answer some of them.
Okay, go.
So, with regard to the technology, yes, it is changing. It has somewhat leveled out. I've been in solar for 10 years. It has finally started leveling out. But, however, since we are the owners and operators of the system, it's in our best interest to make sure it's running at its peak performance. We are guaranteeing how much it produces. So if the technology changes to a point where the system would be sort of obsolete and not producing what we need it to produce and what we've told you it was going to produce, we would change it and it wouldn't cost money. However, we've got the warranties and we've got the projections in place with the equipment that is designed with the system. In answer to your question or comment about whether it doesn't produce enough, that's where we have that performance guarantee that tells you how much it will produce, so you can get an idea of what you still would be purchasing from Unitil. There were a couple more in there I probably forgot at this point, but those are the two.
I forgot them too.
So just, you know, overall, it is a 20-year partnership. Mm-hmm. We do, again, it is in our best interest to keep it running and keep it running well and keep it maintained. So we would be there, you know, along with you.
We do pay them every month for what they produce. But at the end of 5 years, 10 years, we evaluate what they produced against what they guaranteed they would produce, and that's in the power contract. In fact, I ran through those numbers the other day, so I couldn't figure out where she got them. Took me a couple of minutes to figure it out.
I appreciate also all of the work that all of you have done, and I hope that we can find out these answers that we need to have to proceed, and I hope that we can get them fairly quickly. Mm-hmm. So that this comes to a good conclusion. Did either of you ladies on either side want to say something?
I just want to give a lot of credit. He's put a lot of time and effort into this, and
yes.
You know,
he's a hard worker.
Because he cares, so
I'll make up for it in February. That's where I'm going.
Thank you for saying that.
Absolutely, ditto. He has taken me under his wing as a new member on the committee, and
Julie just joined us not too long ago.
April,
so.
Something like that.
Yeah, somewhere around there.
But anyway, kudos, and I'm cautiously optimistic that we're going to overcome all of the barriers that are so out of our own control, but it's a good proposal. It's solid.
Well, thank you very much for coming in tonight. We appreciate it.
Thank you.
We're
going
to
take all this, and hopefully we'll get some good answers.
Yeah. Just turn this guy off, I guess. I don't know. I'll leave it.
I've noticed that there's a lot of people working for Solar City. I keep hearing people say, oh, my daughter works there, or my son works there, so it is growing quickly.
It's fine.
Yeah, I've just started seeing the trucks around, too. It's
yeah.
Great.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Next, we have Rayanne Dion, Conservation Coordinator, and Jason is back. Sorry that you had to wait all this time.
That's all right. That's all right. It's been interesting.
Oh, at least I don't feel so bad that you were coming in anyway. Thank you.
Yeah, so I'm Rayanne Dion.
Yep. Jason Bashan, Town Planner.
So we are here tonight to seek your support to apply for a technical assistance grant that is being offered by the Rockingham Planning Commission. RPC recently received funding from the Northeast Region Ocean Council to provide assistance to our 7 Atlantic Coast communities. And they're offering $6,000 of staff technical assistance. The project would run between December of 2015 and September of 2016. And the overall project goal is to focus municipal efforts to adapt or implement adaptation strategies, improve municipal and community resilience to coastal flooding, protect public health and safety, and increase awareness of coastal flood risk and hazards. So we fall into several of those categories. Mm-hmm. So Jason will talk about the project that we think, or some of the ideas we have for proposals.
Okay, well, under the program for the Tides to Storms 2, it's called, there's a number of potential implementation projects that the RPC has identified. Some involve zoning ordinance amendments, some are amendments to your site plan or subdivision regulations, master plans, coastal hazards chapter, land conservation plans, municipal policies and practices, various community outreach efforts, and grant writing are among the options there. Consideration that we were looking at, and actually spoke briefly with Julie mm-hmm. today from the RPC about this, is under the zoning ordinance amendments. To take a really good, close, hard look at our flood ordinance. Last year we did update it to it for the proposed maps, which are supposed to come into play in 2016, but to really look at it for things like freeboard requirements, which is to elevate the buildings 1 to 3 feet to accomplish those efforts associated with the base flood elevation and getting reduced premiums, flood insurance premiums are involved with that. But not only freeboard, but we feel this is an opportunity to look at other efforts that can help to gain. We're working on the community rating system process, as you know, and to gain those credit points and hopefully get even a higher level than we might get going in. Hopefully we do. But I think this can only add to that. It just adds additional benefit to what we're already working on. It seems like a good opportunity to pursue that right. through this grant, and that's our thought on it.
Yeah, and there's no funds required on our end. It's simply monies, the assistance from them. So we don't need any support for money. So a nice thing.
Do you want to comment on this, Mr. Welch?
Well, I think it's great. They're going to spend somebody else's money to exactly. do what we need to do.
Mr. Waddell.
Great.
Mr. Bridle.
No, I got no problem making a motion that we allow them to pursue the grant.
Second.
I think it's important that you try to get the points added up so that we can mm-hmm. qualify for further reductions yeah. in the future. Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
Mr. Bean.
Prepared to vote, sir.
We have first, a second. Any further comment? All those in favor? Unanimous. Right. Thank you very
that
much.
Thank hard. You very much.
We appreciate it. All right. Okay. Next, the approval of minutes.
Also move approval of the minutes of November 2nd with corrections.
Second.
All those in favor?
Oh, corrections. Okay, on. Do bear with me for a second. I have a few little. Okay, on page 10 of 12, under the police tasers, it says Selectman Woolsey, Mr. Breen, it should be Mr. Reen, R-E-E-N. And take out the word person, it has no business being there, and it's Batcock Avenue, B-A-T-T-C-O-C-K Avenue. And on, let's see, I think that's it, sir.
Yep. All those in favor, unanimous. Moving on to the town manager's report, Mr. Welch.
Mr. Chairman, members of the board, just to remind everybody, leaf collection started today. Materials include leaves, pine needles, grass clippings, materials that are biodegradable, should be placed in biodegradable paper bags or loosely packed in a container. Pickup will be on the same day as your trash collection pickup, but it will be done by a different vehicle than the one collecting your trash. The town has encountered a problem with cleaning catch basins. Do not place your dog waste bags in the catch basins. Yes. It is a federally prohibited practice and is punishable under the environmental protection laws of the United States. One of the reasons we have such stringent rules and regulations at the harbor is because material comes through the drain system and goes into the harbor and pollutes it. It gives certain pollution environments to the harbor, and dog waste is one of those items, as well as waste from seagulls and other animals.
Motor vehicles can no longer be parked on streets in Hampton from 1 a.m. to 7 p.m., excuse me, yes, 1 a.m. to 7 a.m. daily until March 15th, 2015. I did notice this morning as I came through town that we had a, what I would call a plethora of vehicles parked before 7 o'clock this morning on roads. There were quite a few, and I know that the police department is going to be out issuing tickets. So please, we don't want to issue any tickets. Please just don't park on the street between 1 o'clock and 7 o'clock in the morning.
A plethora.
A plethora.
Wow.
Yes. Surprising number. I was astounded. Some streets are absolutely bare. Some streets you couldn't find a parking space on it if you wanted to. Mr. Chairman, I have received a notice from the police department that they're going to be doing firearms training on the 21st, which is this coming Saturday, from 9 a.m. to 5 p.m. So for those folks who have sensitive ears, please be prepared for that eventuality.
They won't be shooting at the fire department.
They will not be shooting at anyone. They're going to be shooting at targets, and I think that's really a good thing to do. We do need very good marksmen in the police department, but we really don't want to shoot anybody. Mr. Chairman, I've received a request from the chairman of the budget committee. Mr. Pierce had requested information, and this has now been made an official request to the budget committee, and this regards medical costs and budgets for Blue Cross Blue Shield and the various Blue Cross Blue Shield components. And with your permission, I will answer those requests. I think that's appropriate for us to do. We're just putting it through the system, so there's at the request of the chairman, so there's no question about what's going on. And we want to try to stay with the system so that we know things are functioning correctly. I did engage on the basis of coming to the board, James St. Jean, or J. St. Jean, to sell a property at 27 Pearl Street.
Oh.
And one of the conditions that he had originally put in his first proposal was that it would be sold with no minimum bid in place. I went back to him indicating the town has approximately $100,000 worth of outstanding costs in this property. Yeah. He's suggesting that we start the bidding at $75,000. I would like to know how the board feels about that. What would you like to do? Would you like to have a reserve equal to the amount of money owed to the town, or would you like, which is somewhat larger than $75,000, or would you like to start the bidding at 75? That's a question. The other question I had was, and I know you don't have to do this, I'm just raising the issue because I wanted to plan my schedule. In years past, you've always taken the week off for a board meeting with the week that Thanksgiving follows in. If I get my tangle all untunneled up, I can say this. That would be November 23rd, which would be next Monday. And my question is the board considering doing that? And if you are, please inform me so that I can set my schedule for various hearings and other things.
Okay. Why don't we take the first one, and it's
Mr.
by
St.
itself.
Jean.
About the
sale,
the auction.
Yes.
Okay.
He's been very accommodating. There's no charge to the town for doing this. He's not charging the town. This is all coming out of someone else's pocket, named the buyer. Currently, the town has $89,710.68 that we have been owed on this property since the time of taking, and all taxes due at that point. So. He's suggesting that we start the bidding at $75,000. I don't think that's an unreasonable sum. It's probably going to go for an awful lot more than that. I will remind you that this $89,007 is once those funds come to us, all the remaining funds go to the prior owner because we've not held the property for 3 years.
Okay.
But the property is in fairly bad condition, needs to be sold. We need to get rid of the liability. And there are a lot of people interested in the sale.
I would move that the minimum start at what the town is encumbered by the tax liability.
Mm-hmm. I'll second.
Further discussion.
So we have a first and a second for the $89,000.
And change.
Whatever. Yes, sir.
Okay. And no other comment? All those in favor? Unanimous. Okay, what was the other thing?
The second was, Mr. Chairman, the board has always taken off.
No, before that, there was another one that you asked about.
He asked about the day off on the 23rd.
He mentioned something else that I was concerned about.
Oh.
Just before.
Oh. Let me go back.
It was another question.
Okay. I don't remember it myself. Pleasure to meet you.
Pardon?
Dog poop?
Well, no, it wasn't a question.
Questions for the town manager's report. Mr. Waddell.
Set.
The only question I have, go ahead.
Budget committee question.
Thank you.
Yes, that's what I was questioning.
Thought I heard you, Brian.
Need the board's permission to do that.
I think that.
Yeah.
Yes.
There's a consensus, definitely, yes.
Very good. Thank you.
I was going to ask you about that, Phil. Mr. Waddell.
Set.
Do you want to weigh in on about the meeting?
Meeting? If we don't have anything on our plate, just that we have to deal with, fine, if it's always been done that way.
So moved.
Mr. Bridle?
On the meeting or questions?
Questions.
Well, it kind of tongue-in-cheek, but on the dog feces issue, what are people supposed to do with it?
Well, put it in the containers that are over there.
Catch basin.
Can you put it in a trash receptacle?
Yes.
And the town will take it?
It can go in your regular trash.
And the only reason I'm asking this is because we have a person up by us who she had left her trash cans out, and somebody had picked up their dog poop, had it in a plastic bag, put it in there, and the lady screamed and hollered at her that the town wouldn't pick up her trash if that was in there.
We don't handle the trash. It's not like the old days when you had to pick the bucket up and dump it. We have a mechanical device that does that.
So I did have this question, and it was shortly ago.
And it can't go into a compost facility because of the type of waste it
right.
is. It has
right.
to go to a...
It has to go into the trash. Right. So there is no problem putting it into a trash receptacle.
I have seen things that have stated that you're not supposed to put it in the trash, so she's not alone. I have seen that somewhere.
Okay, well, I just want to make sure that I thought that was the case.
As far as I know, there is no prohibition against putting it in the trash.
Right.
In fact, it's about the only place you can
put
it.
It's not good.
And then on the
gardening.
The day off next week, I don't have a problem with that.
Okay.
As long as we haven't got anything.
Is there something that's pressing about next week?
No, I'm trying to plan my agenda for my tasks for the next 3 or 4 weeks. And if we're going to have an interruption in the middle of us for some reason, as you've done in the past each year, I'd like to know that before I get there so I can plan accordingly. We're set up right now to do all the warrant articles for bonding on the 30th. And I have to start immediately scheduling right after that the hearings that are required if you approve any of those bonds. So I kind of want to get my schedule in sync with what you wish to do.
Mrs. Mosley?
I object to taking that off. We've been swamped. We're swamped with warrant articles. We're swamped with decisions that we have to make. It's the end of the year. I think we're way too slow this year, and I think that's ridiculous to take that off. But why run for office if you're so anxious to take half the summer off? And now Thanksgiving, what are you going to do, bake your turkey on Monday? I object.
Mr. Bean?
Yeah, I stepped into the budget committee that Mrs. Woolsey stepped down from. I did about 4 union meetings last week, probably did about 30 hours. I'll move that we take the 23rd off.
It sounds like there's a consensus to begin with.
Sorry. I want to vote. He made a motion.
I second
Let's vote
it.
On it.
We have a first and a second. All those in favor?
I'm opposed.
4 and 1 against. I wanted to ask,
sure.
Did you have any other questions?
No, sir. Thank you.
I have questions for the manager. Go ahead. I have questions for the manager.
When Mr. Nyan was just here, what time did he say that meeting was going to be on the 2nd?
I don't believe he said a time.
Okay. Can you let
me know?
We can
find that out.
Yes.
I'll let you all know.
Yeah, and about the televising it also.
He wanted to schedule a time on the 2nd, and that'll depend upon whether or not it can be televised. So we'll find that out first, then we'll schedule a time and put it on the 2nd.
Okay. Mrs. Wilson.
Two quick things. The Pinto complaint on Dearborn Avenue and Moore Avenue, has anyone had a chance to get down and look at the situation? You were going to send down, I think, the deputy fire chief to take a look at it?
I was going to send down the deputy chief of police to look at it.
Chief of police, okay.
And yes, I believe the police department has been down there, although I don't think they formulated any ideas. They're keeping a watch on it, so to speak, very quietly on marked vehicles. And I'm expecting to have a report maybe tomorrow from the chief as to what they're doing.
Okay.
I know they're working on it.
Excellent, because I know they certainly are concerned. And I have an inquiry once again. I brought this up earlier in the year from a resident on the mailboxes that are damaged by plows. There apparently is no change, but I just want to clarify on the board. I thought we could take a second look at it. This is the private development that is off Little River Road and Raymond Lane, actually. And the individual has not yet replaced the mail. It wasn't just the mailbox. It was the granite post that was knocked out by the plow.
Right.
And our employee who hit it with the plow did report it. It was all properly reported and so forth. But this lady is still complaining that they have not replaced it and they're required by their covenant. I'm assuming that's a private road?
It's a public road.
Public road.
The covenants are private to the properties.
Yeah.
My understanding from the research that we did, and I'd have to go back and confirm this to make sure that it's correct.
This has been a number of months.
Was that within X number of weeks or months following the sale of the last piece of property, that the Association of Homeowners had to approve and re-record the covenants.
Okay.
If they did not, they're not in effect, and our understanding is they did not.
Okay, that's a big help.
I'd have
help.
To go check that, but that was my understanding. I have to talk to Christina, and she did her research on the individual covenants.
I appreciate that. But our
and I'll make sure she tells you. So
okay, that. But our posture is still the same on damaged mail. It's not just the mail box. It was the whole...
And anything dealing with a mail receptacle.
We're still at $35.
That's what the board voted.
Per
unit.
Okay. I promised I'd ask, so thank you.
That's fine. And I will ask Christine to revisit that and give you the information that she found.
Okay.
And I think I'm quoting her correctly, but I want to make sure.
All righty.
Now, what about this here?
Information for you?
Yeah. Did you want to comment on it?
Christina, not Christina, the finance department put this together. It's a summary of claims and materials for renewals on Blue Cross Blue Shield. It's a rundown of everything. Claims of medical claims, reported prescription drug claims, total of reported claims, less claims with excess, net reported claims, medical and prescription drug adjustments. It's quite extensive. She put this together as general information for the board because some of these questions have been asked by various people. And she thought it was important for the board to receive this so that you could, in fact, digest it. And if you had questions, please, she's the one who made it up. Please get a hold of Christy, and she can expound on that, or I can have a general meeting expound on that.
It's all her fault.
I don't think it's really personally her fault, but she put together the facts and figures that were sitting out there.
That's good.
Okay, thank you. And next we have old business. To vote on approval or disapproval of warrant articles.
Boy, here we go. Last week's warrant articles.
Let me quickly go through them for you so that you can give me a yes or a no. Full-time Parks and Recreation Foreman is the first one. I'm going to do these by departments.
Okay, great. Okay. Did you want to comment on this, Mr. Waddell?
Which one's that?
The full-time Parks and Recreation.
Foreman. Position. You know, I see the need, but I'm not in favor of, and we just talked about the Public Works.
So that's an F.
Yeah.
Mr. Bridle.
I think there's a need for it. I'm just hesitant about supporting it right now. I think, you know, there's a department that brings in, as you said, $600,000 a year just in parking fees, plus all the stuff she brings in for the rest of her department as far as the programs and stuff. One way or another, we have to get her some more help. I would like to see this position. I understand the board's position, but if we can't do that, then we may ought to look at talking to her about adding some more hours or people to her staff.
Part-time.
Right. So.
Mrs. Wellesley.
Parking has nothing to do with this particular position. I can't reasonably vote for any new full-time positions this year.
Mr. Bean.
Negative.
Can't do it.
And a negative for myself also.
I take that as a no. Recreation Infrastructure Special Revenue Fund, that's the spending of funds that have been acquired from the 20% from the parking fees, mm-hmm. and the amount to be appropriated is $115,350.
Yes.
Yes.
Yes. Yes. I think we've got 5-0.
5-0. Yes, sir. Conservation Land Acquisition Fee, that is a fund. That's a request for $20,000 to be placed in that fund.
Yes.
Mr. Waddell?
And that was 10,000 up in?
That was 10,000 until this year. They've requested 20.
And the excess goes back into the general fund or to lower taxes?
No.
No.
It's a fund.
This goes into a fund.
Just builds up. Fund.
But if there's more than 20, what happens? And where's the money come from?
This money comes from general taxation.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So it'd be $20,000 to be raised from general taxation to go into this reserve account, which would be available to purchase land or to take easements or other indentures on land as that becomes available to the Conservation Commission for conservation purposes.
And there is money there now?
There is some money there now,
$21,000?
Yes. Well, it's no.
That was 16.
60,000, I think, was the figure that was mentioned.
But when you go to buy a piece of property like the Batchelder land, it's going to cost you a lot more.
No, oh, my goodness.
Yes or no?
Yes, absolutely.
Yes, Mr. Chairman.
So that's 4-1.
4-1. 4-1. Okay. Land use change tax fees.
Yes.
Conservation is requesting that 100% of land use change tax revenues or fees that are collected by the town be put in the conservation mm-hmm. land acquisition.
That's what I was talking about. That's,
okay.
I was right. confused.
Okay.
There's
two of them dealing
with
that.
Would you like to comment on that, Mr. Welch?
Having sat as a position of a selectman myself, I can tell you, and having owned current use land, a large amount of it, I can tell you that the people that I've always talked to in the current use program expect to pay a penalty fee when they take their land out,
right.
And they've always expected that fee would go to the general taxation of the town to reduce it, because, and I'll give you an example. A piece of land that I owned, I think I paid $28 a year in taxes on it, 15 acres. And the regular tax on that would be in excess of $3,000. Mm-hmm. And my personal feeling was that the other people in town gave me the benefit to keep that as open land, and they had the right to use it. I take that right away. When I take that land out of current use, they should receive their money back that they paid me.
Mr. Wardell?
Against.
No.
Mr. Bridle?
I think 100% is too much. I'd rather seen it more 50, but that's not
what they did send a letter.
They reconfigured that for a cap of 10,000 for the conservation land fund.
Did you want to comment? Yeah, come, sure. Please join us.
Jay sent an email around that.
Yes.
We understood some of your concerns, and so the adjustment was 100%, and to adjust the 10,000 to 25,000
on an annual basis. 25.
Yeah,
so I have no problem with that.
That was the recommendation.
Okay. Mrs. Wolseley.
Yeah, I'm in favor of the newly configured.
Mr. Bean.
I'm opposed.
And I'm opposed. So that's 3-2.
I'm opposed.
You're opposed.
Opposed.
3-2. No.
Against.
Tax deeded land to conservation.
Yes.
This would amend, or this would provide that parcels acquired through tax collector's deed, which include or abut tidal or freshwater wetlands and have no structures located thereon, would be retained by the town under the jurisdiction of the Conservation Commission.
Yes.
Mr.
Read that again, please.
Oh, for God's sake.
Parcels acquired through tax collector's deed, which include or abut tidal or freshwater wetlands, and have no structures located thereon, be retained by the town or the Conservation Commission.
Would you like to comment on that, Mr. Welch?
Well, that basically means that if the town takes a piece of land, and if it's in the wetlands, that would be included. If it's a land that abuts the wetlands, that would also be included.
Yeah.
So you're taking land out of use?
A lot of it's underwater.
Wait, I'm asking the town manager.
The way this is worded, if the land is buildable, it would be taken if there was no structure on it.
Against.
Mr. Bridle.
I'm against, only because it does take it out. I mean,
Mrs. Wolseley.
You're sitting here complaining and talking about, just talking with the planner and Rayanne about building and the wetlands. You're talking about King's Highway and all this stuff. You don't want to get some of this land that abuts.
Mrs. Wolseley, yes,
I am absolutely in favor of it. We shouldn't be building next to the wetlands.
I think it's hugely problematic, and I oppose it.
Yeah.
Okay, and I oppose it. 4 against, 1 in favor.
This is a contingent article. This is to amend the Ice Pond Warren article. As you know, I think we mentioned to the board that this has no non-lapsing date on it.
Right.
And that the funds were appropriated. They must be spent in this fiscal calendar year. I will tell you that the bid has gone out, and it's supposed to be due back the end of the first week in December. So I would suggest holding this. Mm-hmm. Until such time as that bid comes back in to determine
right.
whether or not there was sufficient funds to do the work.
Yeah, you may not need the article.
On
and yeah. We may just throw the article out.
Right.
So with your permission, I'll hold on to it.
Yes.
Okay, that concludes special department ones. The next one is to accept the lettered streets at the beach and to discontinue E Street. They're inseparable.
Yes.
So moved. Yep.
Mrs. Wolseley?
No.
Mr. Bean? Did you say yes?
Yes, sir. I'm sorry.
And I say yes, too. So that's 4.
4-1. 4-1, yes. I don't want to say 4-1, no. I better write yes. Human service agencies?
Did we hear back from them on that?
We have not. And I'm going to suggest to you that we should put $2,000 in there.
Leave it.
Is a very valuable agency
service.
For us. We take a lot of services from them every year. I would want to see that discontinued. Other than that, we have received responses back from every single agency.
Right.
And there is a little bit of growth in it, but not tremendous.
And if they should fail to show up at all, because they should, if they want their money, then we could take it out at the deliberative session.
Well, what happens is I'd leave it in.
That's what I'm saying.
And they would,
leave
they would
in.
Have to send us a letter to claim the money.
Right.
That's what we do.
Okay.
So.
Yes.
Yes.
5-4.
5-0, yes.
Okay. Amend disposal of surplus town equipment and materials ordinance to allow that metals and other junk material could be sold to metals and junk dealers directly.
Yes.
Yes.
Yes, 5-4 for it.
Change the name of the cemetery burial trust fund.
It's not high on my list, but I don't have an objection.
The change would be to the cemetery maintenance trust fund, which is really what it's being used for.
Whatever. It's fine by me.
5-4 for it.
Okay. I don't think this one's going to be that smooth. Amend the conditions of the real estate trust fund.
No, absolutely not.
This would allow borrowing money from that fund with no interest.
Okay, Mr. Waddell?
I understand the concept that Mr. Bean has put forward, but I think it's an income producing. And I think the way it was originally set up was for income producing, and I'm against this one.
Mr. Bridle?
I like the concept. I like the concept. I think this Warren article has a lot of unanswered questions for me. You know, I think we should have, there should have be a limit on it. There should be maybe at not a 0% interest, but maybe even a 1% or half what the bank is or half of what we can borrow it at. But the way it's written, I can't support it.
Okay, Mrs. Wolseley.
Absolutely opposed.
Yeah, and when everything gets shut down, that's going to go on the Warren articles. And we're sitting with $23 million in the bank, and you're getting $10,000 a week from the trustees. Continue to look at degrading infrastructure. Continue to look at those seawalls down there, because taxes just went up. And no one's going to vote for these money articles. And it's going to be a big waste of time. And the money's going to sit in the bank. And that's just the way it's going to go. I vote for it.
Yes. I would like to, if there was a way that this could be done, that this something could be used here if it was a dire emergency, that's how I would be in favor of it. So I don't think it's worded quite that way. So I would be against.
Okay.
So it's 4-1.
Town War Memorial, $5,000 planning money.
No.
Mr.
Well.
Yes.
Yes.
I don't think we need to.
No.
No.
Yes.
And I will go along with it also.
Okay.
4-1.
Okay.
All right. Reserve fund for unusual weather events. I know that was discussed again tonight because Public Works brought it up. That would be a $50,000 appropriation into a reserve fund.
I'm for that.
Yes.
Mrs. Wolseley?
I'm opposed. That's what the undesignated fund balance is for.
Mr.
Bean?
Yes.
And I'm also against it. So 3-2.
Okay.
4.
Town office safety and energy improvements.
Mr. Waddell?
How much was that for?
$100,000.
That was for $100,000.
And where was that coming? Was that tip?
I got to read it.
Is that coming out of the undesignated?
No, it's not.
No.
And what's the save? Do we know what the savings on that's going to be?
The payback is before the recent increase in electric and heating rates was 15 years. So it's going to be a little less than 15 years.
That's a very long time.
And it's, could you just read it one?
Oh, yeah. Shall town vote to raise and appropriate the sum of $100,000 for the purpose of making safety and energy improvements to Hampton Town Office Building through the replacement of all exterior windows with shatterproof safety glass, with smaller triple pane safety windows, with opening side lights to increase efficiency, reduce heat loss, and cut air conditioning costs, and to authorize the Board of Selectmen to apply for, accept, and expend for such purposes any funds from the state of New Hampshire, the federal government, or any private source that may become available. Non-lapsing appropriation shall not lapse until the work is completed on March 31st, 2019, whichever is sooner.
You know, I'd be more in favor of it if it said that we were going to apply for grants first
Well, you can't change the wording.
Maybe there'll be more grants out if, with all this terrorism going on in the future.
I'm going to say no right there.
Yes.
I'm in favor.
Negative.
And I am against also.
Very good, 3-2. Compensated leave trust fund. That would put $100,000 into that fund, which currently stands about $1.4 million in arrears.
I'm for that. That's yes.
Yes.
Mrs. Bosley, are you suggesting that this would be used for the undesignated fund balance at some point?
It is saying $100,000 from the undesignated
fund. Taking it out of the undesignated fund balance. I'm voting no.
Yes.
And what were you?
I was yes.
Yes.
Yes, yes.
Yes.
And I'll go with it also, so that's 4-1.
Okay. The last one, I think it's the, no, it's not the last one.
Oh, four.
Sorry. the revaluation of public utility properties.
Yes. Actually.
Mr. Waddell?
Yes.
Yes.
Mrs. Wolseley?
Yeah, I just have one question in my mind about doing the next era part of it. Did he give you an alternative figure on that? If
no.
We take next era out?
Actually, you can't.
Okay, well.
How much is
I'm
it
I'm not
going
to get into it. It's $225,000.
$225,000.
No, because if they can go with the state valuation for that one, since we're on the pilot, I'll pull back and say no on that one.
Okay.
Mr. Bean.
Yeah, I think it's important that if you're a $5 billion corporation or you own a $500 parcel of land in this town, that we're all treated fairly. And I can't vote anyway other than yes for that.
I've seen a lot of problems the whole time I've been here, and if this would have happened before, probably many of these problems wouldn't be here. So I'll also vote
yes.
Yeah.
Okay. True.
Yeah, because the state
20 years lease on the solar, which you heard tonight, and we're going to have to wait for an answer for materials that we need to get to you so that you can make a decision.
Okay. Other old business, Mr. Waddell, no. Mr. Bridle, no. Mrs. Wolseley.
Not that I can think of at the moment.
Motion adjourned at 2011.
Well, we have new business.
Yes.
Almost.
Okay. Dedication of the annual report. Did you want to?
I emailed Christina and asked to have it dedicated to former Fire Chief William Sullivan.
Right.
I don't know what else came in.
Does anyone else have a nomination?
Haven't really given.
This is something that's every year. It's pretty hard to really.
Yeah, I mean
to consider everyone. That might be a good consideration, but.
If I may, Mr. Chairman, I'm not going to let Skip hang out there. I'll second that.
Yeah. I think that I saw Skip the other day at the War Memorial, and he has had a lot of praise coming his way from many places. I think it's nice that his own town can give him praise also.
It is good. It is good. I mean, he's served this town twice as a fire, well, once as a firefighter.
Yeah.
Up to a captain and then came back as a chief for a long time.
Right.
He served as a selectman.
Yeah.
And he's done a lot of good work in this town. So.
He's still very active.
Yes.
All those in favor? Unanimous. Next, about voting to send a support letter, HHSA for DAR Historic Preservation Recognition Award. Mr. Welch.
Mr. Chairman, we had received a request to support a nomination. I don't want to mention any names on TV. but it's for a particular society in town that we're all familiar with, who has been nominated for an award by the DAR Historic Preservation Organization. And I think it's very appropriate.
Oh, absolutely. I'll so move.
Second.
I'll set, yep.
All those in favor? Unanimous.
Very good.
Other new business, Mr. Waddell?
No.
Mr. Bridle?
Nothing.
Mrs. Wolseley?
You wore everybody down. We're all...
Mr. Bean?
I motion, sir, at 22-13.
Second.
All those in favor? We missed closing comments, but that's okay. Mr. Wolseley?